Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I'll remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. The first item of our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. The second item on our agenda today is to take evidence as part of our community wealth building inquiry in a round table format. And we're joined in the room by Matthew Brown, who's the council leader at Preston City Council, Rob Davison, who's the strategy manager at community wealth building at the South of Scotland Enterprise, Ian Gulland, who's the chief executive at Zero Waste Scotland, Angus Hardy, who's the director at the Scottish Community Alliance, Louise Kirk, who's representing the Ayrshire Community Wealth Building Commission, Neil McEnroy, who's the chair of the Economic Development Association of Scotland, and Linda Somerville, who is the Deputy General Secretary at the Scottish Trades Union Congress. And online, we're joined by Stacey Dingwall, who's the Head of Policy and External Affairs at the Federation of Small Business Scotland. And I warmly welcome everyone to the meeting. And I'm going to begin our conversation this morning by inviting everyone to briefly introduce themselves. And that may seem odd because I've just named you all, but it's part also because we get to hear your voice and just kind of speak into the space. So I'm Ariane Burgess, convener of the committee and also MSP for the Highlands and Islands region.
Hi folks, I'm Willie Coffey, MSP for Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley and also the deputy convener of the committee.
Hi, I'm Louise Kirk, I'm Head of Service for Economic Development, Growth and Regeneration at North Ayrshire Council, and I'm here representing the Ayrshire Community Wealth Building Commission.
Thanks. Just before Miles goes, sorry Miles, you don't need to operate your microphone, so just we'll take care of that. One less thing to think about. I know you weren't, but others were.
Morning, I'm Miles Briggs, MSP for Lothian Region.
Good morning, Rob Davidson, Strategy Manager for Community Wealth Building with South of Scotland Enterprise.
Morning, Matthew Brown. I'm leader of Preston City Council. I also work part-time for the Democracy Collaborative think tank.
Gordon MacDonald, MSP for Edinburgh Pentlands constituency.
Morning, everyone. I'm Neil McEnroy. I'm the chair of the Economic Development Association of Scotland, but my day job is the global lead for community wealth building with the Democracy Collaborative, who are a USA-based think tank.
Pam Gossel, member of the Scottish Parliament for the West Region and a member of this committee.
Ian Gulland, Chief Executive at Zero Waste Scotland.
Morning, everyone. I'm Linda Somerville, from Deputy General Secretary from the STUC.
I'm Mark Griffin, MSP for Central Scotland.
Morning. Angus Hardy. I'm the Director of the Scottish Community Alliance, a coalition of Scotland's community-based networks.
Good morning. I'm Stephanie Calhoun, MSP for Uddingston and Baleshill constituency in Lanarkshire.
Thanks very much. And yes, as I said, welcome to the session. Apologies. Yes. Stacey, apologies. Would you like to introduce yourself?
No problem. Morning, everyone. It's Stacey Dingwall, Head of Policy and External Affairs at FSB Scotland.
Thanks so much for joining us. We're going to turn to questions from members and I'll just give you a little bit of the kind of how to involve yourself. So usually a member will direct a question initially to somebody, but if you want to join in to and comment on that, please indicate to myself or Kath. And Stacey, if you want to join online, just put an R in the chat function. And as I said earlier, there's no need for you to turn microphones on and off, as we'll do that for you. So I'm really delighted that we are doing this roundtable this morning, and it feels like we're getting quite a start on the fact that the government is talking about a community wealth building bill. But my sense is that community wealth building, and certainly some of you are representing that, community wealth building is already happening in Scotland to some degree. So I think initially what I'd be interested in understanding from you, and maybe I will direct this question to Neil to start with, just give you that heads up, is that do you have a sense in your work that we really understand that community wealth building will bring the benefits? Is there agreement across Scotland around that? And how does this approach differ from what's gone on before, for example, with community empowerment and inclusive growth? And I know that you talk quite a lot about the idea of the pre-distributive and redistributive model of that. So how do we ensure that that is really taking place?
Good, thanks for that. Is it convener or chair? What's the best way of describing it? Chair?
Convener.
Thanks, convener. Look, I think three things to say on that. Firstly, is that there's lots of great things happening in Scotland anyway that's under the orbit of community wealth building. Its beauty is that it brings them all together, and by bringing them all together, it amplifies and scales the impact of all those great things. Yeah, so it's an intentional way of bringing, strategic way of bringing lots of good things together. The second thing to say is that for many years in Scotland, we have had, you know, regeneration, a process of redistribution to poorer places and poorer people. That's not enough. Work is not enough. We need to think deeper about how more Scots can actually control the economy in terms of being shareholders, stakeholders in that economy itself. And so community wealth building is fundamentally saying, hold on here, can we redirect the wealth in Scotland? Can we create a productive Scotland so more Scots have a genuine stake in it? And that is where we get to the redistribution and pre-distribution. Redistribution says we grow the economy, we tax, then we redistribute it. What pre-distribution says is let's make more Scots have a fundamental stake in the economy before and during economic activity. It's almost like a wealth stakeholder society, if you like. Now, the third thing to say is that we know we have aspirations for a well-being economy. We know we have aspirations for a progressive Scotland, a Scotland where we're all prosperous and greener. What community wealth building is through its five-pillar model, it's deeply practical. It's actually a practical way of delivering on a well-being economy and inclusive economy aspirations. It is strategic. It's got big aims in terms of this wider wealth stakeholder society. But it actually, you can start with procurement. You can start with fair work. You can start with community ownership. You can start with, you know, community ownership of wind activity. You can start with a credit union. You can start with a community shares. It takes all those great things and it's somewhere to start, but it seeks to amplify and scale them up. Thank you.
Thanks for that great beginning. Anybody else want to come in on that? Does everyone agree around the table that community wealth building is something that we need to be pursuing here in Scotland? Angus?
Does this come on?
That's on, yes.
All right. Yeah, it's interesting, Neil's sort of overarching kind of reference to community wealth building as if it kind of subsumes all of this good stuff that's happening in Scotland already. And I think eventually that's where we need to get to. But I also think that we don't yet fully understand what community wealth building is and the extent of it. And I was reading a piece of research from Glasgow Cali that was commissioned by the Royal Society of Edinburgh, just came out last month, which kind of reflected a fair amount of confusion about what community wealth building is. Some people saw it as a values-driven tool for economic development. Others saw it as a mechanism for organisational change. And others saw it as a kind of space for the community development agenda to further develop and take, you know, the whole community empowerment journey to take that on to the next stage. I mean, my view is that community empowerment to a large extent has stalled in Scotland, and so I think, you know, I really welcome the community wealth building agenda to that's now beginning to be developed, because I think it will take community empowerment, the kind of the principles of community empowerment, into that next iteration. But I do think we need to sort of build a national consensus about what community wealth building actually is, and get everybody at all levels of society, not just government about to legislate, but local authorities, community sector, third sector, everybody understanding what it is so that we can all buy into it, because it requires sort of multi-tier buy-in to make it work. It's not going to be something which we can deliver kind of top-down.
Thanks for that. Matthew, you've had experience in Preston around community wealth building. And do you have the sense that when you were first starting out on that community wealth building journey, there was confusion and the work to try to get people to understand that it's not necessarily a values-driven form of economic development, but it's more than that?
Indeed. I think people struggle with new ideas. I think there's resistance to new ideas, generally, culturally, within institutions, within politics, within economic development. And myself and colleagues found that because what we were doing was responding to several things. I mean, like lots of areas, Preston's a very less well-off, you know, diverse working-class communities who had been let down by the current economic model. We'd also had the failure of conventional corporate developer-led approaches to city centre regeneration. An imposition of the worst forms of austerity in the northwest of England. And we were trying to respond to that. And this is where we came across work in Cleveland, Ohio, around even in tougher conditions that we had, how they were really trying to, you know, regenerate the communities that way through anchor institutions, democratic ownership and the rest of it. So it was tricky. It still is tricky because there's still one or two closed minds. But I just think... In terms of what communities face, whether it's the northwest of England, Scotland, or wherever it might be, I think we need something new because we've had decades of an economic model nationally that is letting people down, and the inequalities we're facing is really severe, and that's amplified based around, you know, gender and ethnicity. So this is why we started community wealth building. And the exciting thing for me in Preston is how this has spread to places like this and internationally, but also how in Preston and in Scotland we're seeing a dynamic where this is embedding itself within communities, within faith organisations, unions, small businesses that are working with local government and regional government and anchor institutions and other things to actually make those changes.
Thanks for that. And in your experience of it, how do we make sure that it doesn't just end up being this kind of... I think what I'm hearing talking to people around Scotland is that there's a concern that it's just it ends up being another form of economic development. How do we really make sure that it is about community wealth building, that it has that redistributive, pre-distributive aspect to it? How have you done that in Preston?
Well, we got various levers that are looking at different things. So, say, for example, promoting fair work and a real living wage. That is something that is very redistributive, and that is something that can be done across the local public sector together as well as the private sector and through procurement and other elements of the economy. So it's really that collaboration. The way we're doing it is we've probably got about 20 or 25 policies that are being implemented, sometimes the council on its own, sometimes with partners, sometimes within the community, and trying to bring about a really resilient democratic economy. So whether it is the council itself building cinemas and regenerating museums and using local suppliers, whether it's us establishing worker-owned firms with partners, whether it's community land trusts or insourcing, whether it's what we're doing across the northwest of England with partners trying to establish a regional cooperative bank to stop wealth extraction. It's all those pillars together, really. And that is where we're getting the success, but also we're getting community... understanding and community support for it. It's not easy. And also the trying to get big institutions like the NHS to change. In Preston, the NHS is recruiting people in the areas of the highest deprivation and focusing that recruitment on women from minority communities. So that is very exciting in the sense that they're in secure employment and it tackles that deprivation, really. I think the challenge you have is that because it's not one big thing that's happening at the same time, it's hard to communicate it to the people. But obviously, we've got quite a sophisticated comms strategy now that's looking to do that.
OK, that's a really interesting point. How do we take the people with us? Louise, I want to bring you into the conversation because obviously we visited Great Cymru and we saw some of the work that's been happening in North Ayrshire. And as part of the Ayrshire Community Wealth Building Commission, you've obviously been doing this work. But I'm going to kind of bring in another question, which is that in all of the work that you've been doing as part of the commission, obviously we're looking at this now because we're anticipating a community wealth building bill. And so it'd be good to hear a bit about your experience, but also what have you kind of bumped into that has indicated that, yeah, we do need some legislation, we do need some primary legislation. What's in the way of you being able to really flourish in what you're doing?
Thank you, Convener. Obviously, just to give a kind of overview of the Ayrshire Community Wealth Building Commission was formed in 2020 and is a partnership of 9 organisations. So the 3 local authorities, NHS Ayrshire and Arran Police Scotland, Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, Ayrshire College, Scottish Enterprise and our third sector interface. And the purpose of the Commission is to progress and promote the development of that collaborative approach to community wealth building in Ayrshire, and it's currently chaired by the leader of North Ayrshire Council with support through our economic policy team. Beside that, we have an anchor charter, which was developed in October 2020, and that's 16 pledges across the 5 pillars and climate change. And we have 11 organisations signed up to that charter, including the 3 Ayrshire Integrated Joint Boards. So in developing the regional approach, we've kind of identified that we needed a dedicated resource with a lead organisation to coordinate that activity, and also that the coordination of that activity has taken time to obtain buy-in, develop strategy, and requires a focused effort to support those organisations not traditionally involved in economic development activity, but to recognise their role as economic influencers and take forward community wealth building in the way that's the most appropriate to their respective organisations. We've delivered a lot of sort of similar activities, as Matthew's outlined there, in terms of we have 3 work streams in relation to land and assets, fair employment and procurement. And sort of taking that regional approach has helped support activity across the anchor institutions more generally. In particular, some of the anchor organisations have appointed sort of programme managers to help support and deliver on their ambitions. In terms of the sort of challenges associated with that, finance is obviously hugely restrictive for authorities, local authorities and other public sectors, and their competing priorities and increasing pressures. And I think that's where we feel the legislation could help support that, and also kind of create an opportunity to take a look at the funding landscape going forward. And the legislation, we're hopeful, would provide a kind of more coordinated approach to that delivery. The Community Wealth Building Commission obviously submitted a full response to the legislation, kind of outlining its ambitions to support this. And similarly, the Community Wealth Building Commission members are supportive of a duty that aligns with option C, so a kind of hybrid approach that allows organisations to embed community wealth building within their strategies, as well as producing a collective place-based community wealth building strategy going forward. And we've recognised that the ability to deliver community wealth building is dependent on the anchors having adequate capacity and resources to collaborate and engage. And that's why within the Community Wealth Building Commission, as it stands, we've concentrated on those first 3 pillars, recognising that that currently some of our anchors don't have capacity and capabilities to support the other 2 pillars, and therefore kind of looking for flexibility around about the duties to allow us to prioritise activity based on capacity, local needs and challenges.
Okay, great. Thanks for that. Does anyone else want to come in on the general sense of community wealth building and how this approach differs, and also why you think we might need new legislation for this? Because I get a sense that it is happening in Scotland. So what have we come across at the moment that would say, we need the legislation? I mean, Linda's indicated the kind of financing aspect and a more coordinated approach there. But anybody else got any thoughts?
Stacey. Sorry, Stacey.
Oh, okay. Stacey, you want to come in. Great.
Thank you very much. Yeah, so for small businesses, the most important pillar of activity, as you'll know, there's the five pillars of activity. So our focus is really on the spending pillar as the key one for FSB and our members. So as you'll know, Scotland's been through quite a journey in the last decade in terms of procurement reform. And one of the main aims of that has been to increase that public spend with micro and small businesses in particular. So in the last 10 years, we have seen a bit of progress on that. But we feel that with community wealth building, there's an opportunity here to build on that process, that progress that we've made in the last 10 years. So for example, to look at the stats, in 2019, FSB did a report which looked at 5 years on from the procurement reform legislation, how much spend had increased with our smallest businesses, our micro businesses in particular. So that would be those with fewer than 10 employees, and how many of those were winning a larger share of public contracts. So if you look at the data that Public Contracts Scotland produces every year, sometimes they'll provide details on procurement spend by size of business in Scotland for that year. So the last available report, which includes this data, which is from 20 to 21, shows that only a small proportion of the value of contracts awarded that year, which was more than 13 billion, went to the smallest enterprises in Scotland, despite them accounting for the vast majorities of businesses in Scotland. And then if you take that back to 2016, 2017, which is often referred to as the baseline year for procurement, you can see that there's not been any progress made since between 2016 and 17 in terms of the spend that's going with the smallest businesses. In fact, there's been a bit of a decline in progress since the introduction of procurement reform. So something like community wealth building, where there's talk about introducing statutory targets in order to get that procurement spend up, we can see that there's been some progress across Scotland, particularly with the community wealth building pilots in Clackmannanshire, for example. They've put a real focus, they set a target for increasing the proportion of spend with the smallest businesses in their area, and they actually achieved that before the deadline that they'd set for themselves. So we believe that there's evidence there that shows that if we set these statutory targets within the community wealth building legislation, then we will make some progress on the government's aim of procurement reform and increasing that level of spend with smallest businesses.
OK, thanks for that. I've got a few people have indicated they want to come in, so I'm going to go to Linda, Rob and then Neil. And then Matthew, I'm going to come to you and ask you, how did Preston do it without legislation? So, Linda.
Thanks very much. I mean, I'd certainly echo some of the comments that Matthew's made about the kind of failed economic models and development models that we've seen. I mean, the shift to out-of-town retail, for example, you know, has devastated our high streets, and that, all of that's been obviously compounded during COVID and beyond that, and a lot of businesses have never, ever recovered. And the impact on the workforce and the workers has been enormous. Scotland is actually, despite having Fair Work, you know, as a key priority for the Scottish Government, there has been some change there, which we really welcome, around the real living wage being implemented in certain places. And that's now embedded within the government's grant giving as well, as a new part of procurement to look at the real living wage. But the reality is there's still lots and lots of workers that are left outside of that and without actual control of employment law. Under this parliament, it's quite difficult sometimes for government to do more about it. However, we do think that there is more that they can do to actually implement Fair Work, which would be one of the key pillars that would be needed for community wealth building. And the real living wage, as I say, is a key component of it, but we need to do a bit more than that. The expansion of sectoral bargaining is one of the things that would certainly help, because when we're talking about creating new jobs, we're talking about creating jobs that are quality jobs, that are meaningful jobs, and that give secure employment to people. And one of the best ways to do that is through collective bargaining. And the government actually has an aim under the national performance indicators to expand collective bargaining in Scotland. So we would like to see that that approach is taken towards any part of community wealth building bill that comes in. It's not easy, but it's well overdue within social care. So social care in Scotland a number of years ago identified that as a key sector, that for low pay, in work poverty, and insecure employment at times, predominantly women, and with a large black and minority ethnic workforce, a proportionate workforce within that. And yet the government has still not managed to implement sectoral bargaining within their Fair Work implementation in social care. So, you know, I think the government's ambition in this, I think, should be applauded, but they need to actually get on and implement it. One of our concerns probably is, and the consultation showed, that there was over, I think, 25 or 28 pieces of significant policy directives that the government was currently working through, national strategy for economic transformation, wellbeing economy, a whole load of others that would be impacted by community wealth building. So unless there's significant resource and political direction and leadership given to it, both from government and across local authorities, and other institutions, Louise has outlined the type of institutions you need on board at a regional level to make this happen, then we would be slightly concerned that it's just adding another strategic aim to something without actually the resource behind it. The consultation again showed repeatedly through the consultation responses and the summaries the need for resource, because the reality is that our local authorities are struggling. There's increased demand across all of our their services, and there is a workforce that is really, really struggling because of resource to deliver that. So there needs to be some thought given to that in terms of, you know, when it comes to where the spend goes, but where are the spend coming from? Where does that budget come from? And I know people on other committees have argued with me about, you know, what's on their spreadsheets, but the reality is, if you speak to your constituents and say, is the service you get from your local authority right now, whether it's, you know, paying in, getting out, asking for something, needing help, whatever service that is it better, worse or the same as it was before the pandemic? You're going to hear worse most of the time. So there needs to be something done about thinking, how do we resource particularly the local authorities to deliver on this? I think if we've got this ambition, and we would very much welcome the discussion around that. I mean, the corporations and, you know, the market-led approach that we've had this decline in growth across most of our cities. And what you outlined about Preston there could apply to every city, parts of it across Scotland, and our towns as well, because rurally as well, there's a huge impact. And I think that's often why we've seen rural communities, and I know that Angus will probably have more to say about that, take initiatives, because people feel a bit closer to decision-making sometimes and think that they can actually do something a bit more about it. Just thinking about the workforce a little bit more, I think recruitment skills and training initiatives, particularly for those in low-income sectors and areas of the or geographical areas, is something to be thought about. Apprenticeships needs to come into the picture as well, because all too often they're missed out when we think about workforce planning. And we look at how this might impact, you know. But we also need to make sure there's trade union involvement at every step of the way. And I'd be interested to know what Matthew's experience was of that in terms of people getting on board with it. The consultation talks constantly about collaboration, the need for collaboration both across institutions, across organisations, and with workforces and with communities. And that really is about building trust. And I think people at the moment, a lot of their experience hasn't been about building trust, either with their employer sometimes, or indeed for communities trying to access services. So I think we need to think quite carefully about how, you know, as much as strategic comms strategies will help that, but it's really action where people can see things delivered and see that they are valued within that, both within communities and in workplaces, where they believe they've got some agency within that to actually make meaningful change. So, I mean, that's one of the things that we would want to be looked at. But in general, I think the idea of community wealth building, if it's not just another strap line to wrap around a lot of component parts, but actually has both that strategic aim but a meaningful action plan that both that people can regionally and locally get on board with, then yes. The last point I wanted to make just briefly there is actually thinking about, and you mentioned it, and adding climate to the pillars, how does this fit with just transition? Because there's a huge opportunity to look at, when we're creating jobs, what are these jobs around green growth as well, and how does that fit, you know, with the Scottish Government's ambition around just transition. The Future Economy Scotland, a think tank in Scotland, has recently just done a piece of work around community wealth building and just transition, which the committee might want to consider as well. So I'll leave it at that for just now.
Thanks very much, Linda. I think that's really helpful, and thanks for pointing us to that resource. Okay, I'm going to go to Rob and then Neil, and then I'm going to come to Matthew with the question about the legislation. And then I think, Ian, you've indicated, but also I think maybe some of you wanted to come back in on things that other people brought up. So please feel free to do that, Rob.
Thank you very much, convener. I think thinking about the legislation and the impact that it could have, so in the context of the south of Scotland, certainly it is a region in which you quite legitimately say there is a good deal of community wealth building already happening, has been happening in an entirely organic way, I think, and over a number of years. to a large extent, perhaps even predating any particularly widespread knowledge or understanding of the term itself, but examine individual projects, individual communities and their ambitions against the five pillars, and they obviously match up. I think that's one of the strengths in community wealth building, incidentally. But where I think that legislation, and where SOSI thinks legislation could have value, is in terms of establishing community wealth building as a national priority. Legislation gives it a degree of authority, arguably, and it may help us collectively to get to the point where there is perhaps more of a critical mass in favour of community wealth building, which strikes us as being a valuable target. Having said that, setting those ambitions, I think, is really vital. It will be equally important to try, if possible, and I'm conscious the parliamentary adjustment will probably not like this, but to try and frame the legislation in such a way that it actively encourages as much local design of the practical implementation as is at all possible. I recognise that's a bit of a tension. And in turn, while we think it's probably the best way of doing it, it's highly likely that that will create a significant ask for resource, a significant resource requirement, probably outstrips what is currently available. So we're very conscious and we're very respectful of the fact that, you know, some of our other partners in the south of Scotland are more concerned and reticent about a duty and concerned about its implications, particularly for their resources and capacity. They don't have the luxury of staff who have been dedicated to this at present, and are naturally concerned about that against the landscape of competing priorities that we've, I think, heard reflected around the table. So it may be that what we see as the best way forward in terms of legislation does create a conversation that is required about resource and how we support that very individual and bespoke way of implementing community wealth building on the ground. South of Scotland, so far as we're concerned, that's absolutely critical. What will work in Selkirk just won't work in Stranraer, for argument's sake. So retaining that locally rooted and bespoke attitude towards the development of community wealth building, we think, is critical in whatever direction that the legislative agenda goes. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. And I think certainly the committee would be very supportive of that. I think we're aware from all the work that we've been doing over the last wee while that Scotland has a very nuanced landscape in terms of community needs, and that's what we need to be really looking to support. I'm going to bring in Neil.
Yeah, the approach that Scotland's taken to community wealth building has been kind of three legs to a stool, really. There's been obviously the practice in the five pilot areas. There's been movement building, if you like, in terms of many other players being made aware of community wealth building and starting to do things, and the health boards is a case in point. And then there's this policy and legislation. And I suppose there's three things important about the potential legislation is that I work across the globe and I see many administrations, and I see lots of good things in Scotland, but it's quite cluttered. And so I believe that a community wealth building legislation could kind of declutter that landscape a bit. It could be a unifying piece of legislation that brings many things together across those five pillars. In a sense, it's saying Scotland is a community wealth building nation. It's looking to build a new economic model, and here are the components of that. So I think clutter is a problem for administrations, for governments across the world. And the more that you can declutter while still being progressive and ambitious is the way to go. And I think many administrations are progressive and ambitious. They tend to fill the space with lots of nice stuff, but where is the unifying vision and purpose? And I think that's what community wealth building brings. I think there's many things within across the five pillars that's in the consultation that I think could be amplified in scale. Things around procurement, things around fair work, things around finance, land and property, plural ownership in terms of enhancing community ownership, social enterprise and so forth. There's tweaks and there's changes that may have legislative ramifications across those five pillars. And finally, I would say, is that there is something here about a glue, across the public bodies in Scotland that say, you know, the health boards, for instance, they're obviously making people better and not get ill, but they are an economic agent. They buy things. They employ people. They have land and property assets. They are an economic player, and they should be seen as one, as all other public bodies should be, including this fine building here, should also be seen as part of the economy. So there's a potential here in the legislation to state that Scotland's economy is embedded in our institutions of the country. And I think there's something there, and Louise indicated in terms of the duty options. I think there's something where there's a duty on public bodies broadly, yeah, to actually embed, solidify their role as economic agents in Scotland across those five pillars.
Thanks for that. So when you say decluttering, are you actually looking at actually maybe removing some legislation that's kind of in the way? I think also you my sense is that the cluttered landscape is also a problem for communities, because there's a tremendous amount of opportunity for communities, but, and Angus might want to come in on this, there's tremendous opportunity for communities, but there's no coherent framework for them to find their way to all of those opportunities.
No, absolutely. And two small examples. I live in Oban, and you know, a very vibrant community. But you're trying to try and develop Oban as citizens. You're trying to link the economic, the social, the environmental, and there is a lot of stuff. Yeah, there is a sense of disempowerment because there is quite a cluttered landscape, and there's different policies and there's different things. I think community wealth building in Oban, community wealth building in Argyll and Bute, community wealth building in North Ayrshire creates that unifying force, and it's kind of a golden thread that runs through it. It's also, in the second example, in the USA, where community wealth building term was invented, you do see things like in the Economic Development Administration, the Federal Agency for Economic Development in the USA, they have community wealth building running through it like a golden thread. In Chicago, they have a community wealth building approach. It is a way of unifying economic and social environmental policy under one orbit of consciousness, but also action and volition.
Thanks. Matthew, I said earlier I wanted to ask you, how did Preston do it without legislation? But maybe there is legislation, but how have you done it?
Well, we had no choice. In many ways, what we found in terms of the restrictions we face with austerity and a failure of the conventional economic development approach. So obviously, we looked around and tried to see what we had already, which was lots of public sector institutions that had land, employed many people, had a budget of £1 billion plus. So we really started with things like real living wage and trying to buy locally. And Neil at the time was chief exec of CLES, so we worked with CLES. A lot of it was very unglamorous for the first 3 or 4 years. It was getting procurement practitioners together and just going through contracts, breaking them into pieces, you know, meet the buyer days, all that kind of stuff. But we managed to dramatically increase spend with locally based businesses, especially construction. And what we did find is that, you know, if a contract worth 15 to 20 million went to a medium-sized construction company, they had a family of subcontractors, often individual self-employed people, smaller businesses, and there's actually more jobs created by doing it that way than having a construction big business, which would extract wealth away from the community and not use local suppliers. So that collaboration of the public sector was very positive. We did things like work with the local public pension fund to invest a little more in the community, and even if you can shift 1% to local investment with the pension fund that's worth £10 billion, it's not insignificant in terms of the investment you get locally. And then, because we were saying things differently, we attracted lots of interest, which is nice, but what was more positive than the interest was the fact that we started getting some funding from, you know, Open Society and others to look at the democratisation of the economy. And then obviously we try to embed these ideas in communities. So, you know, people, former prisoners set up a worker cooperative, people in our minority communities have set up a worker cooperative. There's a digital business, a trade union set up a cooperative education centre. We've got environmental activists setting up a community energy network, which is putting solar panels on roofs of anchor institutions. Just speaking with the local NHS about, do you have some land? Could that be used to develop social and affordable housing? Things like that all made a big difference, really. And we did it without legislation. But if we do get legislation, it'll be even more positive. But very recently, officers have been very good at, you know, successful in things like levelling up funds and towns funds. And that then accelerates community wealth building, so we can now afford to redevelop our city centre, and we're doing it in municipal ownership. So we have that resilience for our community, but also have a say over local supply chains how it contributes to tackling the climate emergency and working conditions as well, really. So that's the way we've done it. But legislation would be very positive, I think, whether that's Scotland or the United Kingdom, because, I mean, the Mór Córa law is an excellent example, which actually gives tax incentives for workers to actually acquire a business and run it as a cooperative business. And the democracy we see here, why not have a lot more in the economy? And the fact we don't have that democracy in the economy enough, I think it's leading to a lot of social problems because people don't have that agency in the workplace. You know, it's very frustrating. Very abnormal we are in the United Kingdom compared to other parts of Europe in terms of the smallness of our cooperative economy, but even compared to some American cities and regions as well.
Certainly in the cross-party group on social enterprise, we've been talking about the need for growing the economy. The social enterprises and cooperatives need to be at least a third of Scotland's economy. So it's quite an effort that needs to happen there. Ian, you had indicated you want to come in.
Yeah, hi, thanks, convener. I'm struck just sitting here, the similarities with the kind of what we're talking about here and the circular economy. I know that was the kind of main thrust of our response to the consultation. I mean, in lots of ways, I mean, even just listening, you know, some of the language that everybody's using, similarities with the approach that, you know, the circular economy is already happening in Scotland. You know, there's examples in communities, and we can talk a bit more about some of these practical examples as well. As businesses, there's a growing demand for circular business models. But I guess one of the challenges is, as others have said, how do you kind of mainstream it, for a better word, rather than it just being to name a broad blanket title for all of these component parts. And that's one of the challenges, I think, of the circular economy, which is very similar to the community wealth building. But the two things are, so that's a similarity, but the two things are intrinsically linked for us. So we do believe that a successful circular economy of Scotland will or can deliver strong elements of a community wealth building approach. And I say can, so one of the challenges with the circular economy, if we don't design it right, we will miss these opportunities. So I really do think this is an important proposal in terms of a bill, in terms of legislation, because I think you do, because there is obviously a circular bill going through Parliament, there's an approach, there's a strategy being developed, obviously subject to parliamentary approval. But not having something similar for the well-being, I think, you know, could disadvantage that to some extent. I think we really need to see the importance of having something in the statute books for all the good reasons. It does create a kind of lightning rod, a coordination, a focus, all of the things. It puts something out there that says we are going to be a nation with well-being at our heart and brigades people around that. So, and that's very similar to what's happening in another part of this Parliament, you know, in terms of the circular economy. How do we bring all of those other actors together to kind of really focus on the issue around reducing resources? And the circular economy isn't just about climate change, as has been mentioned. It is about, you know, tackling lots of other global pressures. But at the heart of it is about tackling inequality, basically, social inequality, not just here in Scotland, but globally as well. So, again, why these two things are intrinsically linked. So I guess that's the similarities, and there's obviously specifics. Why I think it's important to the community wealth building is if we don't link the two things together, certainly I don't think the circular economy will be as impactful in terms of the social dynamic unless we link them together. But also, if we don't link them together, then people who are doing community wealth building will have lost a tool from the box, because thinking about resources, thinking about ownership, thinking about all of the things, business models, community involvement in our management of resources, our, you know, repair cafes, you know, recycling, ownership of materials, being part of that system, because it is a system. The circular economy is how do we change the system. If you're not part of that, if the community are not part of that at a local and a national level and at a regional level, then I think the community wealth building ambition will be a lot harder to achieve. So the two things I really do think need to be brought together as much as we can. But just one thing on I'm not saying it's lessons learned from the circular economy. One of the things we've learned from the circular economy, and others have touched upon it, again, this plays to the why do we need legislation, why do we need a bill, for instance, is that whilst it's all happening and there's great examples, and I could, you know, talk all day about great circular economy business models in Scotland embedded in community activity and the potential and the opportunity, then it is really hard for those things to scale up in mainstream, because the landscape, the ecosystem that they operate in, is to some extent skewed against them. And that's for all the things that people have said. It's about skills, it's about finance, it's about capacity of these organisations to actually get involved in some of the opportunities, both at local and national level. Procurement, for instance, could be much more streamlined to benefit the involvement of those organisations to take greater ownership of the opportunities. So it's the same thing. So it's really about how do we, to some extent, rebalance the ecosystem. That's what we're really at the heart of our work at Zero Waste Scotland, thinking about the circular economy. How do we, this isn't just about focusing on the projects per se, it's about how do we create a new ecosystem for all of these organisations, not just businesses, social enterprises, but local authorities and other actors that have been mentioned already. How do we create a different type of ecosystem? How do we replumb the economy to ensure that there is much more advantage for these people to participate, rather than creating a different type of economy over there for them to thrive and to prosper, but to actually embed it into the mainstream? So it's really about how do we create that different type of ecosystem, which, to be fair, is about policy, is about potentially legislation, regulation, is about duties, it's about that, as much as it is about finance and changing the skills and or embedding in skills and capacity of organisations.
Thanks very much for that, and I really appreciate you coming to the committee and kind of like putting that big highlighter through the connection between the circular economy and the community wealth building bill. I'm just going to bring in Gordon MacDonald briefly. I think you might have wanted to respond to something earlier that was said, and then I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan, who's got a couple of questions.
Yeah, it was a couple of points that were raised earlier on, and before we lose sight of them, I thought I'd better come in with my questions. Stacey, you spoke earlier about public procurement. Obviously, when Public Contract Scotland portal was introduced in 2008, it was cutting edge, brought a lot of contracts together and gave a lot of SMEs the option to bid for contracts. But, you know, my experience in the Economy Committee is that there is a lack of capacity within micro and small businesses, and there is a perception of too much bureaucracy, whether that's true or not. So I was wondering what practical steps need to change in procurement in order that SMEs can basically help keep money circulating in the local economy, because local businesses use local services, etc. And before you answer that, my second point was to Matthew and Neil, and it was, what's the definition of local? If we're going to keep money circulating in the local economy, does it mean businesses that operate in that council area? Does it mean businesses that are registered, have a registered office in that area? Or does it mean where the invoice is paid at the end of the day, which might be hundreds of miles away from where the particular business is operating? So, Stacey first. On mute.
I certainly agree on your second point there. That's one of the issues that we have in terms of measuring that spend within a local economy, because yeah, you can have a business that's just got a registered address in that area, but the money's not necessarily being kept within that area, so it kind of defeats the purpose of community wealth building from our point of view. But you're completely right. Public Contract Scotland, as you said, when it was brought in, it might have been thought of as cutting edge. I don't think that that's the case now. You know, I've certainly worked in a job where I had to deal with Public Contract Scotland every day, and it's a really difficult site to navigate. I think it's achieved its aims of bringing those contracts together, but I think it definitely needs a bit of a refresh. Our members that we speak to, as you say, about 40% of our members are self-employed or just one-man bands, so they don't have that time that it takes to actually navigate Public Contract Scotland. And that's what we hear from our members all the time, in terms of they just don't bother going for contracts because they don't have the time to deal with that bureaucracy in terms of going for it. I think they also feel that even if they did go for it, the system is pretty much set up for larger businesses anyway. And it can be quite difficult when there's opportunities, obviously, in becoming part of a supply chain and, you know, being a subcontractor to larger businesses. But that can be quite hard for them to devote the time and navigate as well. We do see some, you know, obviously, at the same time as I think Public Contract Scotland was brought in, so was the Supplier Development Programme. That's really popular with our members, I think, as Matthew said. They hosted the Meet the Buyer events in Preston, and that's certainly already happening here in Scotland. It's quite widespread. In terms of the programme, I think what it needs is more capacity. So it needs more resource in order to help more smaller businesses. And I think that would be true across the board in terms of local authorities and the support they're able to provide to small businesses to get them more involved in local procurement opportunities.
And there's quite quotes. Is that of benefit to SMEs and should the threshold be increased?
Yes, we'd certainly support the threshold being increased for that because it is a useful tool for SMEs.
OK, thanks. Matthew?
Yeah, in terms of the question around spend, what we wanted to do was dramatically increase spend within the local authority boundaries, but also within the wider county. And we did that pretty successfully. I think at the time it was whether the organisation was registered within the local authority boundary or the county. However, a big part of what we were doing was ensuring we spent with small and medium-sized enterprises as well. So both things were being done at the same time. What we have done as well since then is the developer we're working with to develop much of the publicly owned regeneration is a not-for-profit developer, which is very rare, which is 2 miles from our city centre. And again, through community benefit agreements and other things, they stipulate X number of contracts must be with locally based companies and employ local people within the area.
OK. Just how do we keep the money circulating in the local economy?
Yeah, it's a good question, Gordon. I think we need to think not just about local's a proxy, but it's not the only thing to think about here. You know, community wealth building is about its pro-social, pro-environment. It's making sure that wealth is not extracted in lands, in neighbourhoods, localities, regions, and a nation. So we're not just talking about local, though it's a useful proxy. And I think what's interesting is in terms of some of the, you know, take an example from California, the land of the free, if you like. They have an Employee Ownership Act, right, which is to help businesses, retirees, the owner retires, and it helps employees to buy up with that firm. Now, that is not just about protecting local. It's also saying, well, employee ownership's a really good thing because they're seeing misallocation of capital, particularly in Silicon Valley, where you're getting huge profits being made, but they're being extracted to people making rockets, buying islands, whatever. And so they think employee ownership model is a way of recirculating that capital for innovation, for greater R&D and also for greater productivity. So in a sense, that form of community wealth building in terms of that form of ownership is actually seen as a means by which we have better use of capital but also resources through the firm. And so I'm bringing that in there, Gordon, because I'm trying to say that it's not just the local, it's also about the replumbing of the economy and how it actually functions. And local is a proxy, but it's not the only proxy we need to look at.
But in order to do that, you have to have resource, and what we need to do is anchor institutions to start spending more locally, which helps to supply that seed corn in order to get where you want to be.
Absolutely, but not just think about spending local. Also spending their for goods and services, thinking about how they're attracting, spending their money on firms who are pro-social and pro-environment, no matter where they are. You know, a co-op based in Preston, is arguably more virtuous than a Global Inc. Mm-hmm. based in Inverurie.
Great. Okay, brilliant. I'm going to bring in Stephanie. Got a couple of questions, and I think we've started to touch on some of those areas. It'd be perfect for you to bring in those questions.
Thank you, Convener. So I should probably mention that I was a councillor at South Lanarkshire Council up until 2022, and I'm really interested in the role of community planning partnerships in delivering community wealth building. I'm aware that the FSB have said that significant system and behaviour overhaul is needed. So I'm really interested, and it'd be good to hear from yourself, Stacey, in what role is that you see for community planning partnerships and other existing structures, how those can perhaps be developed. Do we have the right people sitting at the table? Is there a need for legislation around those to change? So I'd be interested to hear from Stacey, Louise, and I think Neil would probably have a contribution, anyone else who's interested. Thanks.
I'm Alan. Yeah, great. Stephanie, you're right. We did mention that in our consultation response to community wealth building, that we do feel that obviously community planning partnerships are in place, and they, you know, they have their place in terms of what they do. But to us, when you look at, you know, obviously, as I mentioned, we've had the procurement reform legislation that has all been brought in, but we're still not at that point where the spend is where we would like to see it with small businesses. So we feel that if, you know, if we're bringing in the community wealth building legislation, it is time to, you know, I don't think we'll be able to achieve what we want to do if we just rely on the same systems that we've had in place. It feels to me that we need a bit of a fresh start in terms of making sure that obviously the community planning partnerships weren't designed to deliver community wealth building specifically. So if we are going to bring in legislation, it makes sense to us that you would look at that structure and, you know, refresh it for what we're trying to achieve now. Obviously, small businesses and certainly some of my colleagues have participated in community planning partnerships for various reasons over the years. But I think it is just about, in terms of particularly small businesses, and I'm aware it can be quite difficult for small businesses to participate in things like that just to, due to issues of time. But I think we just need to look at how we can make it more meaningful and make sure that, you know, a lot of times I think we see that, unfortunately, you know, we have a bit of box ticking. It's like we've got a small business here, so we've covered that. We can say that we've consulted the small business community, whereas if you spoke to that small business, they might not feel that they'd actually been able to have had a meaningful voice within that structure. So I think if we have this legislation and it's got something like the statutory targets, for instance, driving the procurement, and it's actually set out we want to achieve, I think that will help us design a new structure in order to develop community wealth building at that local level.
Question, and I came back to Scotland about 2.5 years ago, and I knew a community planning partnerships, and working on community wealth building, I went, oh, brilliant, community planning partnerships. You've got a ready-made anchor collection of anchor institutions. So quite exciting, because in other parts of the world, you've got to create these partnerships of all the anchors to consider community wealth building. Scotland's got one, the community planning partnerships. Oh, yahoo. And I'm speaking personally rather than representing any organisation like EDAS, but I felt that they're heavy on process without purpose, right? And I think they need the process seems to overtake the actual rationale of what they're trying to do, which is the collective wisdom and power of all those agencies in place. And I do think community wealth building is a way of creating that purpose. Yeah. They could be guardians of community wealth building. And we're seeing it, hopefully, and Louise can talk to this, in terms of other places in Scotland where you've got the anchor charters and you've got anchor partnerships coming together. It's driven by those pillars. It's guardians of it. It could be overseeing and trying to cajole and nudge and push a community wealth building agenda at a local level. So we do need governance mechanisms for community wealth building at a local level. If we're talking about the totality of public, social and commercial agency, CPPs are the place. But it would need to be refashioned to be much more purposeful, much more driven on actions, much more driven on impacts. Please.
Would you say then, are there legislative changes that you would be suggesting?
Whether it gets in that situation where it's legislation or whether it's guidance, it seems to me that I don't know. I'm not sure it's legislative change as such. It's more of a more focused guidance, with the CPPs being key players in the community wealth building agenda, and I think it's inimical or similar to the the anchor charter partnerships we have in some areas in Scotland, including in North Ayrshire and Ayrshire.
Louise, do you want to come? You wanted to come in earlier, but you want to come in on this?
Yeah. Do you want me to cover what I was going to cover there?
Absolutely.
It's just round about the kind of procurement piece and round about the regional approach that we've taken in Ayrshire. So there is a regional procurement workstream as part of our Community Wealth Building Commission, and we've done analysis over the last few years round about supplier spend and local supplier spend in Ayrshire. And we have seen an increase across the board in the last few years in terms of increased local supplier spend. And a lot of that's been down to our approach and pragmatic approach to the quick quote process that you mentioned earlier about that disaggregation of contracts, etc. However, we recognise there are some kind of opportunities to kind of further improve that, for example, through increasing the regulated procurement threshold for supplies and services from the £49,999 to potentially around about the £100,000 mark and to allow for more scope for award locally via quick quote and future increases potentially being aligned to inflation. That would enable local authorities, for example, to progress open quick quotes that are a lot less onerous than the full tender process and to encourage that more local bids. And we recognise the challenges that, you know, that places on enterprises, but also that the quick quote threshold hasn't increased in a number of years. Also through the Community Wealth Building Programme as part of the Ayrshire Growth Deal, we've been doing support for local businesses and supported over 900 local businesses in that sort of period. That has been exceeding targets across a range of indicators and has been raising awareness of what community wealth building is within the business sector and how it can be adopted by them to bring economic benefits to the communities in which they operate. We're also looking across our business development support offer to more closely align that to our recently adopted regional economic strategy, which has community wealth building embedded across it and as a cross-cutting theme, to help further enhance and inform the support that we provide to businesses to help them be suitably prepared to participate in sort of tender and procurement processes. So just to cover that first. As Neil has outlined, North Ayrshire and all three Ayrshires, through the Community Wealth Building Charter, are using it to provide examples of the pledges that anchor institutions can make to change their practices and embed community wealth building across those organisations. I outlined some of that earlier. The Commission is therefore supportive of the proposed organisations that are covered by that Fairer Scotland duty and community planning partners to be included within proposals for a community wealth building duty, and recognising what Neil's already said, that those partners are considered the key anchor institutions within the area and therefore have a high level of significant economic power and influence going forward. And we feel it's important to consider the role of the third sector within this and ensure that the benefits and opportunities created from community wealth building are appropriate. We have third sector interface participation in our commission, and we feel they have a crucial and important role to ensure community wealth building strategies and action plans are relevant going forward. So therefore, we'd suggest any future legislation requires a bit of autonomy to allow flexibility in how best to involve communities, businesses and the third sector within it. And that might include consideration to involve, you know, key groups, community councils, community development trusts and others going forward.
Thanks for that. I wonder if you want to come in with your next question. I know there's some other folks in the room who have indicated they want to come in, but we're almost at an hour, or I think we're over an hour. I think this conversation might need to extend a little bit, but I'll check in with you all about that in a wee while. But if you want to come in with your next question, Stephanie, and then I think we are going to be coming back maybe a little bit to procurement and that kind of thing with another question that's going to come in a bit.
Thanks, Convener. And just a quick comment as well. I have heard people in the third sector say that they should be known as the community sector rather than the third sector. But I'm also really interested in the five pilot areas as well that have happened over the past 5 years. And I'll stay with you for now, Louise. So I'm wondering, what differences is it you can actually see in that area? What kind of data or evidence is it that you're collecting as well of the difference it's making, for example, to things like inequalities?
So the collaborative approach in Ayrshire has been really beneficial in bringing together all of the partners and broadening the kind of understanding of community wealth building and the potential for it. We have seen, as I've kind of outlined, some real advances in terms of uptake, in terms of sort of businesses, procurement, participation in the Fair Work workstream, higher levels of real living wage being demonstrated at a local level, and helping to inform and shape the employability offer and support and skills that are provided across the board. In terms of the sort of measure of that, we are looking at the moment at the Inclusive Economy Dashboard and that a refresh of that with the Inclusive Growth Network and looking across those social, economic, environmental wellbeing indicators that we're currently measuring to kind of help inform that going forward. And are also kind of working across sort of council services to ensure that we continue to measure that. So through the kind of three main work streams at a regional level, we are seeing significant levels of progress and also identifying opportunities going forward to kind of refresh that and kind of learn from the experience over the last 4 years since the adoption.
So those wellbeing indicators then something that need to be kind of front and centre?
Yes, and that's very much about our approach going forward. So we have been measuring those across the board, but we're also reflecting on which of those indicators we can actively influence and what is measured at that kind of local and regional level to ensure that going forward and reflecting on the past, we have indicators that are sort of meaningful to measure progress.
Do you have a perspective on the pilots and how they're going?
Thanks, Convener. Yes, absolutely. If I can mention community planning partnerships as well very briefly, I would absolutely concur with Neil that I think there is potential strength in them as the nascent networks of community anchored institutions that they could become. And I think in particular they could have real benefit, just thinking about Stephanie's point about measuring impact. So, for example, Dumfries and Galloway Community Planning Partnership has very good area profiles that they built up in conjunction with Public Health Scotland, very, very detailed across a very broad range of indicators, which we should, in due course, be able to interrogate and understand. So are there economic benefits, social benefits, health benefits, really across a very broad range? Some of those may admittedly take time to establish and understand. However, I think we possibly have a bit of a question mark over the relationship between community planning partnerships and regional economic partnerships, which I'm conscious Louise alluded to. In the south of Scotland, for example, community wealth building has really been driven by regional economic partnership and the regional economic strategy, rather than by community planning partnerships so far. So how those will interrelate in practice, I think we'll need a bit of thought. It may be, again, that that's not a one-size-fits-all situation, being conscious that really, I suppose, every community planning partnership and indeed every regional economic partnership is to some extent different. Again, that's possibly one for guidance in due course. In terms of our experience as a pilot area, we're certainly at a much more developmental stage. We did start considerably later than North Ayrshire did. So we're still very much building those strategic partnerships and starting those work plans. What we are trying to do, however, is in tandem build up the practical pilots. So, for example, looking at local procurement of energy efficiency retrofit, starting with regional registered social landlords as anchor institutions, but trying to, using an archetypes approach, broaden that out into retrofitting the entire south of Scotland. Not overnight, admittedly, but over the next 20 years, that's worth thousands of jobs and millions of pounds in the local economy if we can get the local procurement aspects right and identify those key kind of critical actions to make that happen and deliver it over time. Early and developmental, but we think in time has the prospect of being genuinely transformational.
That's great. Neil, I wonder if in your role, I feel like you've got the kind of big overview role, do you have any view on what's going on with the Vive pilot project?
Yeah, they were chosen by, I should say that I was part-time seconded into the Scottish Government during the the pilot process just 2 days a week for 3 years. But they were chosen for different reasons. So there were you had Fife, you had Clackmannanshire, you had North Ayrshire as local authority areas, and then you had the South of Scotland enterprise area, and then you also had Glasgow City Region. The Glasgow City Region and South of Scotland enterprise only focused on a few of the pillars, not all of them. I think in all of the areas, North Ayrshire, Clacks and Fife, there's been a number of kind of progress and successes. I think Fife's worthy of note in terms of the way it's managed to connect, if you like, its economic development approach, its poverty approach and its public sector reform together under the orbit of community wealth building, I think is quite impressive. And Clacks is the smallest area in Scotland. They've got some things here they've set up. They've got an employment charter in Clackmannanshire. They've seen a 4% increase in council procurement. They've got a new supported women into business programme. They've got a community anchor partnership. They're trying to beef up and muscle up their credit union. So there's a range of things happening within the pilots that's worthy of note and mention. And going back to an earlier point, if I can, convener, just to say that part of the beauty here is that it gives a licence in some way to some of this so-called smaller stuff. Yeah, it gives it licence as being embedded as this is actually quite significant economic development activity. And also through the five pillars, it seeks to join those things up. So it's not just procurement, it's procurement of a local firm with local jobs, and the recirculation of the finance that comes from that. So there's been good progress. There's other areas that were not the pilots that have also taken up the mantle of community wealth building, including Aghaillean Butte, and I forgot to mention Western Isles, and I think Moray is a number, and Dundee. There's a number of councils taking on this under their own toot, if you like. And why have they done it? I think they've done it because they can see the additive benefit of taking on that approach to their economic and social activities.
That's great, very helpful. Yes, I had conversations with both Moray and Western Isles, and I think that was kind of interesting, where Western Isles is a bit ahead of it, and Moray kind of getting inspiration from them. So that's a kind of peer-to-peer learning aspect there. Stacey, you wanted to come in on this.
Thank you. We have been encouraged by the success of the five community wealth building pilots. Our colleagues who work on the ground in areas with local areas with members have given us significant feedback about the progress that they've seen in the pilot areas. The main way that we track evidence of the impact of these pilots is through the improvement services benchmarking framework. So, for instance, that lets us look at Clackmannanshire, for example. As I mentioned before, they'd set a target in their 2019 strategy to take local spending to 21.5% by 2022, and they actually hit 23.4% by 21. And Fife in particular, they've made significant progress in going from just over 20% of spend in 2010 to over 40% 10 years later. So it's that kind of progress that we are really keen on seeing. As I mentioned, my colleagues on the ground, they tell us that there's two factors which have enabled the progress in the community wealth building pilot areas. So the first part of that is ownership on the part of the local authority, and also strategies with clear targets and detailed monitoring arrangements. So, for example, if you look at Clackmannanshire's annual procurement report that they produce, that allows them to not only evidence to community wealth building stakeholders like our members what progress that has been made, but it sets out the concrete actions that they've taken in order to produce and sustain that progress. So when you compare the report produced by that local authority in that pilot area with those that haven't taken part in the pilot areas, there's a clear difference, and you can see why the progress has been enabled in that pilot area. So, as I said, we have been very encouraged by what's been achieved in these pilot areas.
Thanks for that, Stacey. That is very encouraging. So I'm going to bring in Linda. You've been wanting to come in for a while, and then Angus.
Thanks, Convener. Circling back a bit, some of the questions that we raised earlier, and you talked specifically about institutions a lot, but I just wanted to expand that sometimes in the wording from institutions to also infrastructure, because we maybe are assuming that that's said, but I think it needs to be stated specifically. And thinking about the infrastructure that we have in Scotland and that areas have, and what can be done and what are the missed opportunities around that. Already, you know, we've got a situation where ScotWind contracts, you know, have just been put out by the government as well. You know, Glasgow are looking at how they run their transport system. Just the other Friday, they had made some decisions about franchising for that as well. So we need to think about energy, and we need to think about transport as absolutely key, not just in terms of the buildings and the people within them, but how we can link these up when we're beginning to look at procurement for them and who delivers them. You know, when we talk about community wealth building, the flip side of that really is about stopping wealth extraction in many respects, and that's maybe not the direction that we're seeing some things going. So whilst the government has at the moment said they're investigating this area and they're very keen on it, and most people generally around this table and beyond seem to be looking that that's a good idea, it's maybe not the direction that we're going in with some of the decisions that are being made. So much more can be done about municipal bus services, much more can be done about the benefits we'll get from that for the workforce and environmentally, and also around some of the amazing opportunities that there will be for the workforce under just transition if we do it the right way, you know, and thinking about our energy supplies in Scotland and how we go about doing that. So I think there's something around that. Also, we talk about different models of how to achieve this. We've heard about different models of ownership. Cooperatives are very, very low numbers in Scotland. There's very little expertise, I think, in Scotland around that as well. There is significant, you know, good expertise, but it's not in a very widely available. So thinking about how we can upskill that. But another thing for local authorities particularly, but other organisations to think about as part of this model, is about insourcing and how they take the workforces back into actually into their good terms and conditions that they can probably have, because that's not happened in a lot of areas. We think about procurement. The biggest procurement spend in Scotland is generally around social care. And again, social care is going, much of that money is just going straight into offshore accounts. We did some research a couple of years ago about social care in Scotland and the financialisation of social care, not just for residential care homes, but for other types of social care delivery in the community. And the number of providers is declining rapidly for a whole variety of reasons, not only more so even now since we did the research, because of the costs have gone up. But that means that therefore there's more and more large providers, which means that we're actually at market fracture where we're reliant on people. And if there's any kind of failure in those big organisations, which happens often in the private sector, they pull out and it all gets handed back to the local authority as a duty of care anyway, and the provider of last resort. So the National Care Service, which this government is going ahead with at the moment, looking at the National Care Service, again, where in this National Care Service bill and the work that's going on in that is a priority. We were told it was the biggest change in public sector delivery in Scotland for a long time. And yet actually it's not going to change that fundamental about who delivers the service, and is it still going to be for profit? So when we're thinking about community wealth building, how do we tie it into the things that are already running and make sure that we don't lose any of the opportunities? Because we know for a fact that the for-profit sector, particularly in social care, but in others, is more likely to lead to higher number of complaints, lower wages and better quality, lower quality service being delivered. And we can evidence that. And I think legislation, thinking about what other legislation, thinking about local authorities within legislation should need more power. And that's something that the Scottish Government has up to now been less reliant, very reluctant to do. But actually, local authorities need to have some more powers to raise their own revenue as well. And in fact, we're seeing the opposite approach being taken, for example, with the council tax freeze, which has not been welcomed, I think, by any, predominantly by a lot of people, and very heavily criticised because of the limitations it will put on local authorities to raise their revenue. Thinking about the Fair Work part of it as well, Fair Work gets, kind of thought about in a certain way. The Real Living Wage is a key part of that, but it can't be the only part because it doesn't deliver just on its own. And there's also very little way for enforcement of Fair Work in Scotland at the moment. There's no way to... I mean, we have examples, lots of examples of where procurement has been used to give out government grants, and yet there is still... That's not happening on the ground. The creative industries is a good example of that, where the money comes from Creative Scotland, but they will claim, and they rightly claim, that they are not an enforcer of fair work and have no capacity to do that or inclination. That is not their job. So once the money goes from there, how do we know where that actually ends up in terms of fair work across a sector which is very precarious in nature? So there's, you know, Scotland has an ambition still to be a fair work nation by 2025, which is very soon. And we don't see that delivering at the moment, because there is much more that needs to be done in that area. Key to that as well is, how do you measure fair work? You know, what are the actual parameters are we putting in there? What's workforce experience of that? And how are trade unions involved in it? And again, coming back to collective bargaining and having trade unions at the table to make sure that they're involved in all of these things.
Great, thanks very much for that. So I think we're going to get a bit of I call this a lasagna. We're bringing in lots of different layers in the conversation, and it's tricky sometimes to manage it all. But so I'm going to bring in Angus. I'm not sure quite what point you wanted to come in, but I think it was around the five pilots and that kind of thing. And then Ian, you've indicated you want to come in, and that might be on infrastructure.
It wasn't actually about the pilots, but it's really just a couple of thoughts, just listening to the conversation. Well, one is a small one, but I'll make it anyway, which is something about the kind of appropriation of language around community wealth building, in particular community anchor institutions, which sort of it's causing confusion in our sector, because we, back in 20, around the community empowerment legislation sort of gestation, we tried to find a term which gave us, which in some way embodied what community empowerment was or meant. And we stole a phrase from a Home Office report called Firm Foundations, which is community anchor organisation, which kind of is, you know, a development trust or a community controlled housing association. These are community organisations that anchor their communities. And then as community wealth building has come in with community anchor institutions, it kind of just, people are going, well, am I an institution or am I an organisation? And so it's a small point, but I'm just laying it out there.
It's a small point at all, because when I first started getting into community wealth building and trying to understand it, this was certainly an issue that I've been trying to unpack. And Neil, I see you nodding, so maybe you want to explain what you think, how we handle that. Where does the anchor organisation or institution sit?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's the anchor institution, which is the large public institutions, and then there's community anchor institutions. I think it's part of the growing the movement, I suppose, in Scotland. And you would like to think that there's any legislation, there's clarity over terms and glossary and, you know, all that sort of stuff. And also some kind of, you know, light touch support architecture that starts to make the lexicon real and make sure it's fitting into particular context. I mean, across the world, there's different languages used. You know, in America, the phrase now is backbone organisations for community wealth building. These are your organisations, if you like, Angus. They're kind of community organisations who are they're called the backbone organisations, as they say it. So I think the lexicon's important and the language you use is important, but I think as we mature, we need to get clear and clear definitions, and that needs to be set out about, so it's everybody's on the same hymn sheet. But I don't think the discourse and lexicon it's a problem, but it shouldn't be seen as a problem of competition or competition of overlap. It's more of a question of getting the language right. I don't think there's anything in terms of saying community anchors is different to what you're saying, community anchors. I just think we need to get the language correct and defined.
My sense of community anchors, so again, in talking to people around this subject, there's an example would be Urusgalsen in the Western Isles, and they generate an income of £400,000 a year from three wind turbines. And I would see them as a community anchor organisation. They're employing a lot of local people and really, you know, have the local people in interest. So my sense is it's about context. You used the word context. It's about context. And then also, though, important that the local authorities, if they're the anchor institution or the CPPs, as we're beginning to talk about, are the anchor organisations, that there is real recognition of these strong anchor, community anchor organisations that are really a really important part of the mix. And actually, I think I will bring in at this point something that's been growing in my mind in this conversation is that another thing that we've got going on in Scotland at the moment is the local governance review and the whole piece around democracy matters. And I think there's an opportunity in there in terms of really and more people talking about, and this is even people, I've had conversations with people from COSLA, recognising that communities need to be supported into a place of leadership. So I think there's a lot going on at the moment. It is very exciting in Scotland. Having said that, OK, Angus, you want to come back I'm going to... Yeah, go on. Yep, come on.
Start for 10. The second point, really, which was more substantive, is that within the conversation that I've been hearing again this morning, the question in my mind is, where is the community sector in that conversation? Because it doesn't sound like it's... It sounds like it's in the usual place, which is kind of late to the show and kind of last in the queue. And, I mean, when we read the consultation last year, we got quite excited about it. We thought that community wealth building represented an opportunity to be genuinely transformative in terms of the systems that we all operate within. So we don't see it as a rebadging of what's going on already and just a kind of a nice wrapper, as somebody said earlier, that sort of describes a lot of good stuff. We see it as an opportunity to really seriously move. It's a step change in the way in which we operate. And so in our response to the consultation, we kind of laid out one central proposition, which was that communities, third sector communities, I don't know what you want to call it, should be front and centre in shaping how community wealth building emerges and manifests at a local level. And I think, Rob, you made the point that it's going to be different in different places, which is absolutely right. But where is the third sector community sector in that process? Are they the architects of it, or are they the kind of the traditional kind of recipients of an engagement process? And in order to kind of deliver that central proposition of putting communities at the heart of the process, we think sort of two things in particular need to happen. One is that community wealth building legislation needs to be absolutely locked in right across government, right across all of this. So you talk about the local governance review, circular communities bill, everything. It has to be almost have primacy across all of the policy areas, which I'm not hearing at the moment that's really the expectation. And the second is that the communities need to be enabled to play that role, communities in the wider third sector. And also, I think there needs to be some kind of new sort of alliance between the community sector as it manifests locally and small businesses, SMEs, so that, you know, that we who live and work in these communities can be enabled to really shape the future of these local economies. So, those two kind of key issues. And in terms of, can I steal a mic for another 2 minutes? In terms of the community planning partnership question, I think, you know, the duty to advance community wealth building is going to sit with community planning partnerships. But what does that mean? And we had a couple of suggestions in our response that we thought might give that more substance, which is that in the last land reform legislation, they created the land rights and responsibility statement, which I think is, I mean, it's slowly evolving and developing and becoming more significant in terms of the impact on the ground, in terms of how land is managed and used and owned. And I think a similar kind of statement, high-level statement, that might come through the legislation would set out the kind of key principles and the first principles of community wealth building that community planning partners should comply with. And possibly, I know this will be a resource implication, but similar to the land reform agenda, the Scottish Land Commission, which has the establishment of which has kept land reform on the public consciousness and the policy agenda in ways which otherwise, and in the past, we've seen land reform slip off and become a slightly a sub-text to policy world. And because the Land Commission is there and constantly churning out policy thoughts and papers,
it keeps the ball rolling, and I think we need something like that to keep community wealth building evolving and with new ideas coming in all the time. So those two ideas might give the community planning partnership world a focus on community wealth building.
Yeah, I mean, that's very helpful. And I think it's also interesting that the CPPs were highlighted in the Verity House Agreement as well. So there's something about CPPs that, as Neil said, they're brilliant, but need some help to kind of bed in or kind of move into a more strategic partnership in that way. I'm actually going to suspend briefly, if that's okay with everyone. I'd like to suspend briefly just so that we can understand we're going to rapidly go over time. So I just want to check and get a game plan with everybody, if that's okay. So welcome back to our Community Wealth Building Roundtable, and we're going to bring up some more questions, starting with Pam Gosell.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everybody. Hopefully I can get two questions. There's three questions altogether. I'm going to put two of them together because they would go under local procurement, and then there'll be one after on resources. So my first question is around the FSB and their consultation response highlighted concerns that community wealth building goals might not be achieved if Scottish Government policy continues to align with EU spending protocols. In the Economy and Fair Work Committee, the Scottish Wholesale Association pointed out that complying with EU regulations could prevent initiatives like prioritising Scottish produce as the primary choice. So what kind of barriers would that present to community wealth building and empowering local supply chains? That's my first question. The second one is around for community wealth building to be successful. We all know that we need to remove barriers to smaller businesses becoming involved in delivery of public contracts. So late payment is an issue that was raised by the FSB in its submission to the consultation. And it also features heavily in the Economy and Fair Work Committee scrutiny of public procurement. So my questions around that are, do any pilot authorities have any concerns about the late payment being a barrier to smaller firms' participation in the community wealth building? And if current issues with late payments remain, will this likely be a barrier to the success of community wealth building? And could I ask both questions first to Stacey, then open it up to the pilot authorities, please, or anybody else? Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, the point about the EU spending protocols came when we were completing our consultation response. We held a roundtable of our members who'd been involved in procurement previously and who wanted to talk about their experiences and some of the barriers. So that certainly came from some of our members, that they certainly, it was their belief that if we continued with that alignment, that community wealth building, the aims would not be able to be realised. It's been probably coming up to a year since we spoke to our members about that. So it's certainly, as things move forward, that is something that we would want to check in with our members to see where they sit with that now, a year on from the consultation response. In terms of late payment is just an issue for small businesses overall, not specifically related to local government. Obviously, we know that the Scottish Government has made it very clear in their procurement reform legislation that late payment is something that should not be happening at all in Scotland. And I know that there's been a lot of progress in terms of public bodies, in terms of paying promptly to their suppliers, particularly small businesses. Where we're still seeing the issues, and unfortunately, we do a survey of our members across the UK and in Scotland every quarter who tell us about how they're experiencing late payment. And particularly in Scotland, unfortunately, quarter on quarter, we're still seeing an increase in the number of our members who are reporting late payments. And that tends to be, I think a lot of our members feel that larger companies who they're either subcontracting for delivering services for see smaller suppliers as a bit of an overdraft facility for them. So I think not specifically related to community wealth building, but there just is an overall all concern among small businesses about late payments continuing and being on the rise, as I said, unfortunately.
Thank you, Stacey. If I could open up to any of the pilot authorities, please.
Maybe Rob, do you want to come in on this?
Okay, thank you, Convener. So I think we'd absolutely recognise that we want to minimise late payment across the piece. The RSL colleagues we're working with on the procurement pilot in particular, I think, are absolutely supportive of that and structuring things in such a way that we minimise that. Do you recognise the concern raised specifically that Stacey has regarding contractors vs subcontractors? And I think there's a role for a careful examination of that, just working through how that really functions in practice. In terms of our pilot, though, undoubtedly the biggest barriers that we're facing are skills and accreditation, so retrofit qualifications, past 2035 in particular. It looks like it's going to be quite a significant bottleneck, certainly in the immediate future. That's an accreditation that we think we're really going to need to support local constructions industry in the south of Scotland to gain various methods. We can do that, certainly, but it is quite onerous and detailed in terms of obtaining that, and it's going to be increasingly critical the further we get down the retrofit journey. So part of the barrier to participation in that has actually been in a slightly different direction, and it's potentially not one that we had particularly anticipated when we started, but we're really keen to engage with and support local contractors to work their way through so that they can kind of get the full benefit. Because past 2035, for example, would mean that, you know, they are more likely to be the contractor versus the subcontractor, for example. So you wouldn't be working under another contractor's accreditation, and therefore, you know, perhaps iron out some of those issues that Stacey had identified.
Thanks for that. Louise, you're not a pilot. The Ayrshires are not a pilot project, but you've been doing it under your own toot, as Neil has said. So maybe you have some perspectives on these.
Thank you, Convener. So, as outlined earlier, through our business support offer and all through the Community Wealth Building Ayrshire Growth Deal project, we work very closely with a number of businesses across Ayrshire, and, you know, specifically, obviously, for myself within North Ayrshire, to kind of help and support and understand the challenges to procurement and recognise a number of the points that Stacey's outlined there. As an authority, we keep a close watch across the sort of payment landscape and ensuring that we can minimise the potential for late payments, and obviously our procurement colleagues continue to work round about the legislation. Through recent engagement with our broader business base to help inform a business support offer going forward, we've identified a number of kind of ongoing concerns from businesses in terms of procurement, and are looking to work across our services within the council to kind of tackle those concerns and see where the opportunities and potential changes might come forward. But we also recognised in our consultation response that there is potential for amendment to procurement legislation to allow and help support preferential treatment to local suppliers where the local supply base exists, and that reserving contracts over the regulated threshold for local providers would only exclude non-local providers in certain circumstances, as the supply base doesn't exist in North Ayrshire for all of our requirements. Again, as I'd said earlier, increasing the regulated threshold would also allow more scope for locally awarded quick quote with definite benefits for businesses. And we do monitor the level of regional spend across that work stream, but we are seeing sort of challenges going forward in terms of the potential to keep increasing percentage year on year without necessarily sort of legislative change to support that.
Neil, you wanted to come in.
Just on the EU point, it's a wee bit of a red herring that I heard it quite a bit, you know, that the EU is, Scottish Government aligning to EU procurement rules is fettering our ability. If you look at, like, say, the Basque region, Emilia-Romagna, Barcelona, Quebec, Montreal, Quebec, Burlington in Vermont in America, if you look at Vancouver even, what you're seeing there is it's not really about the procurement rules that's the issue. The issue is about supply. We have a fairly thin set of supply in Scotland. And so what we need to see this as is that we need to bulk up our supply by unbundling contracts, by giving bigger notice for contracts being let, and trying to animate the supply. And it's linked to the convener's point earlier on. We need to grow our social enterprise, small business, cooperative, employee ownership, community ownership sector in Scotland. And that increases the girth or potential for them to be bid and be fit to bid. Community wealth building is not a protectionist policy. It is actually increasing more entrants to the market to compete for public goods and services. And we know what happens when you have competition. Arguably, you can have a better quality and perhaps even lower prices. I've not looked at it, but I suspect in Scotland, if you unpick some of the big contracts that we have in Scotland, you'll find virtual monopolies, and that needs to be unpicked by unbundling, but also creating a domestic supply chain that can start to be bid be fit to bid and compete. And that's what we're seeing in comparable regions, nations across the world. And I would mention Basque region, Emilia-Romagna, Barcelona's areas that do have a density of local suppliers. And that's because they are proactive, aligned community wealth building policies in growing the social enterprise and employee ownership in cooperative sectors.
Into those international examples, we certainly have a look at that. Matthew, you indicated you wanted to come in.
Just really briefly, in terms of very progressive procurement, I was always inspired by the Evergreen Cooperatives. So this was in Cleveland, Ohio, that I alluded to earlier, where the not-for-profit anchor institutions actually bought goods and services from new worker cooperatives that were placed strategically in the most deprived parts of the community. And within those cooperative businesses, there were about 300 or 400 jobs. Just by them choosing to buy new things, not things they bought already, from a worker-owned business, which was then created to, you know, help people in the less deprived communities there. And this is something we've been trying to do in Preston. We're getting close to it with one of our retrofit cooperatives, but we've not been able to do it the way we thought we would do. So legislation will be helpful. Obviously, you've got to be careful around competition rules, and obviously, you know, there's issues around preference and other things. But in terms of trying to have a fair playing field, what we've seen is a domination of outsourcing corporations and others that have actually just won so much of this public sector procurement wealth, and trying to rebalance it with new businesses that are going to be owned in communities by people in communities, so they can share the wealth, seems a positive thing. So if this could be cracked in Scotland or elsewhere, I think it could be really transformative.
Okay, that's a very, very helpful pointer. Pam, do you want to come in with your next question?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for those responses. Stacey, obviously, from the FSB, expressed concerns about the success of the legislation if additional resources are not given to local authorities to deliver and monitor these targets. So my question is around, you know, as we embark on the community wealth building, what can you tell us about the resources needed and whether councils at present have the capacity to successfully deliver and monitor community wealth building targets? So, yeah, it's open to everybody, even Stacey.
Stacey, do you want to pick that one up first? And we'll see who else wants to come in.
Yeah, of course, thank you. I think, you know, obviously, local authorities are struggling at the moment with the resources that they have available to deliver just basic services. So, you know, obviously community wealth building will, especially if we bring forward legislation put and the targets that we would like to see, that's obviously going to put more demand on local authority resources. And, you know, I think we've seen, you see quite regularly now, local authorities hiring for community wealth building officers, managers, that kind of thing, which is great. But I suppose the just concern would be in the current climate. I think someone touched on the council tax freeze as well. You know, with declining resources, community wealth building is going to be something new for local authorities to implement. So it would be our concern if they're not properly resourced to do so. It would jeopardise the success of the legislation should it be implemented.
Oh, thanks for that. So I've got a few people that have indicated they want to come in. So Angus, Rob, and then Louise.
Yeah, just very briefly, I mean, on the resources thing, I mean, this might be an unpopular view, but I mean, as I understand it, community wealth building is, in a sense, asking the system to do things differently, not to do necessarily new things. Or they'd be new, but they'd be presumably dropping things. So it may be just using resources, existing resources, differently. And the other thing is, I just remember back post-Christie, all of the kind of the millions that was lavished on everybody, third sector, local authorities, for sort of transformation funds. I can't remember what they were called. I think transformation funds. Anyway, well, we know what's happened or not happened in that respect. So I just, you know, it might be a kind of obvious reaction to say, well, we need more resources. And obviously, local authorities currently are very stretched and they do need more resources per se. But I just, it's, you've got to be wary of that. I mean, a whole new set of tasks, ergo, a whole new set of resources. Well, not necessarily.
Okay, yeah, that's an interesting point. That is, I mean, certainly some of the kind of conversation that is going on at this time and kind of efficiencies and things like that. And I think also Linda brought in an interesting point earlier around the infrastructure and looking to the renewable sector and the potential. Certainly, Community Land Scotland, Community Energy Scotland have been putting forward, and Scottish Community Alliance have been putting forward this proposal around how do we actually get community ownership, really, of the renewable energy rather than just the kind of community benefit payments. So I think that's something that would be interesting to look at and explore within this mix. Rob, do you want to come in?
Thank you very much, Convener. So I should say that I was an elected member of the Fraser and Galloway Council for 15 years, finishing in 2022, and I certainly wouldn't wish to try and speak on behalf of our partner councils. But I think that both what Angus and Stacey have said, it is actually true, and I don't think they're mutually contradictory. I think we would agree 100% that this is about changing how things are done and how systems work. But I think that our partner councils would probably observe that they feel that it would be much easier to do that, so far as they're concerned, with a little bit more capacity than they have at present, on the basis of the fairly significant reduction in capacity they've experienced since probably around about 2009-10, somewhere in that in that region, roughly. I do think, therefore, that both are the case, and it is an issue. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks. Louise.
Thanks, Convener. So I think reflecting on our learning of the kind of formation of the Community Wealth Building Commission and our approach to North Ayrshire, we've recognised that it has taken as a substantial level of resource. One, to form the Community Wealth Building Commission at that Ayrshire level, and then to sort of lead and kind of coordinate the delivery of that. Also embedding community wealth building across our kind of corporate plans, and that is very much the approach we've taken. It's considered in every committee report, in every proposal round about external funding and opportunities there. Also requires kind of coordination across services, as well as that kind of monitoring and coordination of activities to ensure the maximum outcomes are achieved from the approach, and the time and capacity that it's taken to embed community wealth building across the organisation, we don't feel should be kind of underestimated. The council did and continues to invest in a number of dedicated officers to support the delivery of community wealth building through a range of services and teams. And similarly, NHS Ayrshire and Arran has also appointed a temporary community wealth building programme manager, which has allowed kind of both organisations to lead in a kind of comprehensive programme of activities to align community wealth building with their activities. So for ourselves, through the community benefits programme and our community wish list that aligns to community wealth building as well, but also for NHS Ayrshire and Arran, looking at a community wealth building self-assessment, their community wealth building communication and engagement plan, and the development of a strategy. And similarly within North Ayrshire, we're now progressing with our second community wealth building strategy, but we do have a dedicated resource within our economic policy team that helps drive that across a range of council services. So, you know, we would still be of the opinion that if that true transformational power of community wealth building is to be realised through a proposed duty and or legislation, that local authorities and other public sector organisations, not just ourselves, and also the community or third sector, depending on how we want to refer to that, needs to be adequately resourced to deliver that. Mm. And as I've said, we are looking across the external funding landscape, so looking at projects and funding that comes in, and taking very much a community wealth building approach to that. Matthew mentioned earlier about levelling up fund, and we are taking a community wealth building approach across that, but it does take resource to deliver on that.
But clearly you've decided that community wealth building is an important thing to kind of get out and get on with dedicated officers. Now, what would you say to other local authorities, other councils that are maybe kind of wavering on this? I mean, I think I've heard some councils where they had a community wealth building officer full time, that's now gone down to part time, but it seems to me you've decided to just go out and kind of invest in this in a way. What's made you encouraged to do that?
I suppose that's the fact that we see community wealth building as a key mechanism to achieving a wellbeing economy for North Ayrshire. It's embedded across our council plan, it's embedded within our regional economic strategy. We really see the kind of potential and opportunity that arises from that, and as such have made that decision to invest in that way, but also looking at it across a range of other strategies. So there was mentioned earlier about transport. It's across our local transport strategy. It's informed our spend across a range of external and internal funding sources. And in our business support landscape, we actually measure participation across the five community wealth building pillars and how it's supporting that within enterprises. Mm. So it really is embedded across the council's activity.
So even before legislation, you'd be encouraging other councils to...
Yeah, definitely. And I think that's something the team have been really keen to do. There has been engagement across the board and with other local authorities to kind of help support and sort of learn from our experience, but also, you know, learn from their experience. You mentioned some of the other really innovative approaches being taken by authorities. So we're keen that it very much stays as a priority and it stays fresh and stays, you know, kind of help support and deliver on that, the council's broader objectives.
Great, thanks. I'm going to bring in Neil, and then I'm going to move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Yeah, linking to what Leaves and Angus has said, and I think there's a little bit of lance in the boil here about resources. Clearly, you know, this is about system change, and we know that the economic determinants of ill health can be addressed by policies relating to community wealth building. For instance, there's been a 10%, 9% reduction in mental health in Lancashire and Preston. That's a kind of study that was in The Lancet. So that's a preventative agenda. To do this means there's less demand in public services, means there's more money for public sector, bits of public services. So there's a preventative element here. The second thing is it's a replumbing the economic system. And, for instance, in Chicago, there's a part pivot of traditional business support systems towards cooperative ecosystem. So they see that their business existing envelope, yeah, is being pivoted less towards the mainstream business and more towards the cooperative ecosystem under a community wealth building programme. So this is about repurposing your, or rewiring or replumbing your resources for business and enterprise support. And thirdly, Scotland's got quite a bit, it's my point earlier on about clutter, it's got quite a lot of individual pots of money for different purposes. Community land fund and regeneration funds and so forth and so forth. And these are all great things, right? But I think with a serious consideration of all those funds in the round and having a unified criteria under the orbit of community wealth building could see some rationalisation of those funds and more impactful use of those funds if directed towards community wealth building activities in local areas. So I'm not denying it would be great to have a lot more money, but we don't, right? And we need some resource to oil the wheels, surely. But this is not, should not be seen as a another project, another programme, another big regeneration project. This is about replumbing and rewiring the existing system. And there's something about prevention. There's something about, in terms of repurposing existing forms of support to enterprise and also looking at all the, I kind of call it funny money, but you know those extra monies for different programmes, how that is put underneath a community wealth building lens.
And certainly you were talking about, I think it was you talking earlier about health boards that have a considerable spend. How do they redeploy that and make sure it's kind of it's supporting the local economy rather than leaking out? So that would be an example of here's the resource, spend it in a different way.
Yeah. I mean, it's very difficult, this. The tactics for this is very difficult because the pressure that's under the immediate crisis and ill health, people coming at the A&E, there does need to be given licence for health boards as part of anchor partnerships, part of community wealth building, to see themselves as economic agents and not just see the preventative agenda as a preventative agenda. It's actually a wider economic community wealth building agenda that actually has a playback into reducing demand on their own services and savings for the Scottish public purse.
Mm. Yeah. So I'm looking forward to seeing this roll out, but I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs with a couple of questions.
Thank you, Convener. I think my questions around those not traditionally involved have been answered, but just to follow on from that question, Neil, just wondered, and others as well, what role Scottish National Investment Bank could play in this, do you think?
Do you want me to come in that, Convener?
Yeah.
The part of the finance pillar on community wealth building looks to create a effective ecosystem of different types of financial instruments and different types of financial leverage across the piece. In the United States, there is many, many more different forms of financial, public, private and other forms of investment routine regimes, but also how it is returned and how payment returns. Scottish National Investment Bank is a great thing, for sure. I would like to see it have mission, some of its missions that are targeted on the plural ownership of economy, cooperatives, employee ownership, community ownership, all that sort of stuff, and also have a, be perhaps its what's required for its return is be perhaps given more patience in the market. So the return is not just 5, 10, it's 15, it could be 20 or 30 years in terms of turning around the Scottish economy. So I think SNB has a really important role, but I suppose speaking individually, not representing the organisation, I see it as a fairly traditional investment type bank and not cutting edge in terms of dealing with the climate crisis and dealing with wider questions of wealth extraction that we see elsewhere in the world.
I want to just set that up a little bit, because I read in our papers that a Preston Council worked with other councils, set up the Northwest Mutual Bank, a new regional cooperative bank. So it would be great to hear you going to pull that into your response to, because do we have to rely solely on the Scottish National Investment Bank? Could there be smaller banks that are more regional?
Yeah, indeed. I mean, the... We're in the process of establishing the North West Mutual across the northwest of England. You might want to look to the Welsh Assembly as well, because there's interesting work there, because the First Minister, current and former, pledged to establish Bank Cambria, and that's going to be a regional cooperative bank across Wales, and we're trying to do similar in the northwest of England. There's a similar expression in Avon Mutual, which is Bristol, Somerset area as well. That's quite essential, just because within some parliamentary constituencies in England and Wales, and I presume Scotland as well, there's been something like 70-75% of branches which have shut, because often the big banks don't want us to have, access to our own money, you know, and they've actually withdrawn from the high street. And the idea is these banks will actually reopen over a period of 8 to 10 years. But what it does need is support from politicians, whether that's locally or regionally or in a devolved parliament like this, really. Not always there, to be honest, to support alternative banking arrangements. So I think you can have an interface of a publicly owned investment bank doing good things like you have here. You can support credit unions, you can support a regional cooperative bank like we're doing in the northwest and in Wales as well. But interestingly as well, there's a movement towards public banking in many American cities, where they're looking to set up banks that will, you know, do stuff that you do with the Scottish Investment Bank, but also lend to individuals, businesses, grow the social economy as well, and provide mortgages. And that's very interesting. And the fact that's coming from places like Los Angeles and San Francisco, you know, with the economic culture you've had in America for so many decades, is really interesting, because they're seeing these vehicles as a way to really regenerate communities. Because, you know, the financial crash 15 years ago, it wasn't people in our communities that caused that. It was the behaviour of very large global financial institutions. And obviously, austerity came from that, because the public had to bail them out. And where you've had a dynamic where you've had a concentration of cooperative and public banks and credit unions, those areas have had resiliency, whether that's Germany or some parts of America or France, where obviously there's a lot more cooperation within the banking sector, really. So that's why we're trying to do what we're doing. And apologies, that was a very long response.
Interesting point. And I'll maybe return to you with my other question, because housing is obviously an integral part, an important part of our remit, but wanted to move on to where potentially housing could be part of this. Rob, you touched upon the work South of Scotland Enterprise are doing with registered social landlords, but you said earlier, Matthew, with regards to auditing of land across, I think, the public sector you're probably referring to, and just wondered what that has then produced or not produced yet in terms of this agenda and the housing crisis, which, you know, many parts of the UK are declaring.
Well, But we're still obviously in a situation where we don't have enough money to develop affordable housing in this country. That's my perception of it all. However, in Preston and elsewhere, doing things like having land commissions, they've done that in Liverpool City Region to identify where public sector land could be used to develop things like community land trusts. I think they're going to have about hundreds in Liverpool City Region. You can do that. You can work with anchor partners that have substantial land holdings and work with housing associations to maximise the amount of affordable housing. You can also use your planning system to ensure developers provide affordable housing. If you do all that together, it's very positive. And I mentioned pension funds before. I know in Greater Manchester, the Greater Manchester Pension Fund did invest in local housing associations, and Manchester City Council provided land, and there were hundreds of units that were provided. Now, if you put that all together, it's pretty transformative, and you can do a lot of this now, even in the very difficult circumstances we find ourselves in. Thanks.
Come in.
Yes, thank you very much, convener. Yes, please. Two very brief points. I think perhaps to take the housing one first, and wanted to maybe just highlight the work that South of Scotland Community Housing has been doing with communities to develop community-owned affordable housing. And a number of benefits to that. So certainly communities having the ownership of assets that are both very socially useful to them, but also should make money. That in many cases, these have been derelict or vacant sites that have been repurposed to a very high standard in a general way. So there's been a triple benefit, you could argue, from that. Now, of course, the volume of these is small by comparison with the overall demand, but in many instances, it's taking place in locations and in numbers of units, in numbers of homes, I should say, really, which are perhaps more difficult for RSLs to be considering, rather than the kind of larger scale that they perhaps tend to prefer to operate at. I was thinking with reference to SNB, we commissioned, South Scotland Enterprise commissioned a piece of horizon scanning work to look at potential value of future community benefit from onshore wind. So about 21% of the national fleet is in the south of Scotland. And so the estimate came back at something like £900 million over the next 35 years. That's just community benefit. It gives an idea of the potential value if communities were to be able to take up the 5%, 10% stakes that should be getting offered, and that the sector deal now says, you know, really ought to be offered as a more standard offer across the piece. The issue, however, is that that scale will be one which is probably more difficult for communities to raise the finance in order to buy into. Again, massive benefit potentially for them to do so. Ownership of things that generate income for communities has got to be a healthy thing, but there is probably a larger hurdle than there ever has been in terms of raising the capital in order to be able to buy in the first place. Conversation, I think, we'd like to continue further, because it strikes us that there's potentially, in direct relevance to the finance pillar, something really strong in that for the medium term.
Absolutely, something that does need to be cracked. Louise, you indicated you want to come in.
Yeah, thank you, convener. So it was just, I suppose, to outline some of the work that's kind of happening in sort of Ayrshire. So through the Community Wealth Building Commission, again, we have a land and assets workstream working across our anchor partners, and what we're trying to do through that is to map that estate across all of the anchor organisations to understand land that's potentially surplus or land that creates opportunities for some of that development we're talking about here. We also recognised within North Ayrshire some of the real challenges around about vacant and derelict land, having some of the highest levels of vacant and derelict land in Scotland, and created a fund to support both communities and landowners to look at opportunities to repurpose land. So doing that feasibility study stage through to detailed design and development. And we have seen some applications with a particular housing focus, but that's recognising some of the challenges and barriers to the redevelopment of land, particularly around the cost of investigating those opportunities and identifying potential solutions to tackle that. We're also working with our communities on Arran, roundabout and Isle of Arran Housing Task Force, just recognising the local challenges roundabout island communities. And as well as that, we as a local authority are developing a couple of pilot town centre living projects which look to repurpose very challenging buildings within our town centres, one of which was a former hotel pub, and another is a former council housing, council house, So I put my teeth back in council office to repurpose that into town centre living opportunities for social housing going forward. So tackling some of the challenges round about town centre regeneration alongside the need for additional housing provision.
Thanks very much for that. Willie, town centre regeneration was an area you're particularly interested in. Do you want to come in at this point?
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, everybody. And that really brings me neatly to the question I wanted to ask colleagues about. Can we have successful community wealth building if we have at the same time dereliction and abandonment, particularly within the urban environment in our towns? All of our towns have this problem. And try as I might, it seems almost impossible to get a change of attitude, particularly by owners to the premises that they own. We know that local people live in our towns, cities and villages, and they have a sense that they own the town and the village, but they don't. You know, the buildings that are in our towns and villages and so on are so forth are usually owned by people that have never been in the town or the village and never will be and probably don't care. So how do we turn that around, do you think? And are there any examples of, particularly for buildings in the urban setting, how do we turn that particular problem around? Because it seems to me that we could talk all day and we could talk about the strategies and policies to implement this if the people on the ground are still living in our towns and villages and seeing this level of dereliction and abandonment in front of their eyes. So I'd be really grateful, and I've heard some good examples from Louise already for Ayrshire, but I'd be really pleased to hear from other colleagues about how they've approached and tackled this.
Rob.
Maybe start with Rob first. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Convener. So Medsteeple Quarter in the middle of Dumfries, I think, is an excellent example. And the problem really was that of vacant and semi-derelict property, certainly above the first, above the ground floor, but also the size of the commercial units that were on offer, which was almost that anti-Goldilocks situation where they were too small for the big players and far too large for everybody else that might want to give setting up and establishing a retail outlet a try. So the purchase of, and by now a substantial proportion of the originally planned block by a community interest company and its subsequent redevelopment in stages, while not finished yet, I think has real real potential to create a bit of a new hub of activity, and includes, of course, accommodation. So repopulating the town centre being a really important part of the overall plan, and also creates much smaller and more flexible premises for a variety of business uses. So you're continuing that mixed-use town centre approach, but doing it in a manner which is perhaps more responsive to the way that town centres work now, and also has the benefit of taking a really sizeable and prominent chunk of the immediate centre right on the pedestrianised middle of the town, right next to the mid-steeple, you know, where everybody is and everyone sees and looks at it, and improving it dramatically by comparison with its previous, you know, relatively dilapidated condition. So I think a really good example of where that's working well.
Do you think it makes a difference that Mid-Steeple Quarter is a community-led initiative, community-owned, community-led? Do you think that's an important part of it? Because I think about the town I live in, and there's quite a lot of town centre living. There's a few empty buildings, and it's kind of like, that's what I'm kind of trying to grapple with. Is it really an important piece that it's community-led?
Yes, I think it has been. I think it has been because I think it's actually created a degree of public support and interest that perhaps any other method of trying to do the same thing wouldn't perhaps have reached. And I do think that's important. There's something about how people feel about the place just as much as the facilities and the services that it provides. And I think Mid-Steeple Quarter could get into that part of the equation in the way that, you know, your general developer perhaps could not.
Okay. Gordon, you wanted to come in briefly on this?
Yeah, just a very quick question. You mentioned Mid-Steeple Quarter. As a member of the Economy Committee, I actually visited, and what they were doing was great. But what struck me was right opposite the building you're talking about was an old Burton's menswear building, which wanted to open as a cafe and restaurant, but because of the council zoning policy, which said that had to be retail open only, it was lying derelict. So how do we tackle derelict buildings in our town centres when the council's own policies are undermining what we're trying to achieve?
So I think there's a big argument in favour of that collaborative approach that we really need to get right in order to do town centre regeneration in a really comprehensive way. So Mid-Steeple Quarter, for example, was specifically highlighted in LDP2, which is very nearly done and going to be succeeded by LDP3, but it was specifically highlighted. It had its own definition in LDP2. So effectively, you had really a green light for the vision the community already had to be implemented. There were no planning obstacles to it. I think that probably the building that you refer to wasn't included in anything like the same way. LDP3 certainly ought to give the opportunity for that to be ironed out, so that that ambition can go ahead, potentially. There would seem at face value to be no good reason not to, because anything is going to be better than the derelict site that it is at the moment. So I think perhaps there's just a slight issue in there in terms of the local development plans being set and fixed and then not necessarily being all that easily updated in between times, that may be just a bit of an unintended consequence. And I think is probably part of what's caused that issue there. Hopefully LDP3 might sort that one out, because ideally you'd want to see this kind of positive donut effect of the, you know, the ripple effect of the good stuff in Mid-Steeple Quarter spreading out across the remainder of the town centre.
Thanks for that. So, yes, yeah, so some kind of coherence in the thinking there. Neil, you wanted to come in.
Very quickly, I think this thing about town centre regeneration is cultural and practical. I think it's been touched upon. I think that sense that citizens in towns have a sense of their own power and having that sense that it's our town. For instance, I'm in Oban, and we've embarked on a process called Who Owns Oban? We don't actually know who owns Oban. Yeah, and just actually surfacing that, and well, bloody hard work, actually, to find out who owns your town, right? But once we've got that, it's surfacing, and there's actually surfaced quite interesting things about who actually owns bits of Oban. London pension companies, distant, you know, yeah, that's a really important thing in terms of cultural. And then practical, you know, it's about ownership and control. So, again, involved. This is not EDA's hat, it's my personal hat, but, like, you know, we've now taken over a local shop, community's taken over a local shop, and have it as a recycling kind of store. So it's about ownership and control. And the more you can get those little footholds, as in the Mid-Steeple Quarter, the better, because that can be a ripple effect. There's also practical things, though. I think it's been touted as part of the community wealth building consultation around compulsory sales orders, where your owners are forced to put the market up for sale if it's derelict, and they're not doing anything with it. So it's not a compulsory purchase. It's just you have to put it to the market.
Compulsory sales
orders. Exactly. Compulsory sales orders. That seems like a really useful, practical thing to do, to bring that thing to the market and get some productive use put to it. So it's cultural and practical. And finally, I would say, convener, is that across the world, town centre dereliction, or the reverse of that, the gentrification and the over wealth extraction of town centres are things that drive community wealth building. The dereliction, in that sense, there's not proper regeneration drives it, but also does the sense that displacement and people getting pushed out, or you're seeing lots of big box retail or lots of like aggressive land speculation, that's also a driver. Community wealth building does that lovely balance, because it's actually giving more ownership and control to local people and local communities. In a sense, it's your turn.
Matthew, is that interesting experience to share in terms of this particular issue?
Well, I think the fact that we're actually getting into the market ourselves, where the big developer approach that we had previously failed, is really interesting, in the sense we're developing £120 million of often commercial regeneration, business spaces, cinemas and the rest of it. And I think that really does set a precedent and has a ripple and multiplier effect. Other stuff we're looking at is community ownership. There's a venue which was a music venue which was going to be sold by the landlord. We've encouraged the Music Venue Trust to acquire it in community ownership. And the fact they actually didn't own the music venue was a problem. Ed Sheeran played there before he was famous. Not been back since, sadly. He's got an invite. But it's a real issue, the fact that the small business, they didn't actually own the venue, the music venue, meant that, because the owner wanted to sell it for potentially student housing, it would have gone out of business. So we're looking at that as well. Also, other stuff around working with our anchor partners. We've not managed this yet, but in terms of empty commercial properties, you know, former BHSs and the West and the rest, which can be in communities for years and years unresolved, whether, you know, the NHS potentially as an anchor partner could actually acquire it and do something with it. We had a COVID vaccination centre in one of our former disused community buildings, but something long term there could be positive, because anchor partners can do things like acquire you know, former department stores that have been out of, that have been bust for years and years, and just it's a blight on the high street for years, sometimes decades, really. So I just think you've got to be really creative and collaborative with community wealth building, and you can do it. But I do get frustrated a lot, because I think we could do a lot more, and communities could do a lot more, and institutions can. But you need to have the leadership and the outside-the-box thinking, which I think is a huge challenge with these things, to be honest.
Kind of a clear message there. Angus, you indicated you want to come in, and then Ian, I'm going to bring you in, because in the papers you talk about a really interesting piece around another perspective on valuing our building. So I'd like to hear you talking about that. Angus.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. It was Neil's comment about that how much of this is really about culture and practice. And I mean, the Mid-Steeple Quarter is a great example. It's kind of standing out there on its own too often. It's constantly been referenced as, look, this is what we can do in the town centre regeneration. And also it's been attritional. For the folk down in Dumfries, it has been really hard slog. And I just wonder whether we can make it, just line our ducks up a little bit more and to make it a little bit easier. So if the systems at large, the council, the public bodies that are around that agenda could just nudge the tiller a little bit so that things happen much more easily. And the point about are the mechanisms that we could introduce to make the kind of transfer of land easier. You know, the in the consultation around the land reform, this speaks to the point about the importance of having cross-cutting across all the policy folios, because, you know, land reform has just been published, the bill's been published a couple of weeks ago, and we thought there was going to be a kind of modernisation of CPOs and also community sales orders. It's not in the bill. Now, somehow, community wealth building has got to be the driver for a lot of what the land reform bill is, and I don't think they're speaking to one another. And I think that's really, really important. I mean, it's an early stage, you know, stage one, and I guess there'll be a lot of scrutiny and amendments and what have you, but I really hope that some of the things that are missed out of the land reform bill that speak to the community wealth building agenda can be reintroduced.
Yeah, I certainly understand that there's a working group on the CSOs and CPOs have, I think the government has made a statement that that's getting reviewed. So there's work being done on that, which maybe doesn't need to be in the primary legislation. But yeah, certainly good points there. Ian, can you come in and just talk a little bit about the idea of material banks and the potential for valuable materials for communities?
Yeah, I can. Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, going back to the circular economy, so, you know, the obvious thing is how do we maximise the value or the opportunity with what we've already got, you know? So, you know, obviously everybody thinks about materials and products, but actually our buildings, you know, buildings in our communities are an asset. So they're an asset, are clearly an asset, whether they're derelict or abandoned at the moment, they're potentially could be brought back into occupancy and could be used by the community. So people have talked about that already, but also they're valuable materials. So whether there's brick, whether there's steel involved, whether there's other copper, wire, all sorts of stuff. So they actually provide an opportunity, you know, in themselves as a building, obviously to be reused and refurbished. But actually, how do we maximise the value of that once they've been built, whether they exist or actually we're building new buildings? And that's something we've been, you know, obviously through the circular economy, is actually understanding what's in your buildings, what are the materials that are there, what's the value of that, both in terms of its use, but also at the end of its life, what could it possibly be turned back into in terms of the individual products? It might be air conditioning units, it might be the infrastructure within it, but it actually just might be the component parts, the actual bricks that could be reused and refurbished
into something else, both locally, so reconstituted into another building? Do we actually think about it? So do we empower? So it's almost like taking an asset register of all of our buildings in a way that's not just thinking about the buildings themselves, but what are they made of? What's the possibilities of that? And could they be refurbished? Could you take brickwork down and redeploy that into other buildings as you're making them? So thinking about the kind of realm, the kind of public realm, and taking a bit more. So instead of just knocking something down and then thinking we could use, you know, we could use it as aggregate, could you actually use parts of it in other future buildings? And we're beginning to see a little bit more imagination in that space. But again, they're individual projects. There's no real, as I call it, plumbing established. It really makes that part of the thinking, the kind of the resource thinking at a local level or a regional level as well. So this is about that creative thinking and trying to understand exactly what we have. So it might not be, so trying to think about the buildings not just as it's a pile of rubble if I knock it down, or it's a building that I have to turn back into a retail establishment or whatever. There's something in the middle of that. We could actually use that and get communities to start imagining the, you know, the absolute value, and see them as kind of material banks. And that's not just in the high, and that's not just in the kind of towns and cities relevant to this bit of discussion, but in the rural aspects as well. But another point, just if I may, just because I was going to talk about the infrastructure, because Linda's point earlier, and just to labour the point, I mean, you mentioned transport and energy, but, you know, okay, we'll use the term waste, but that is another massive infrastructure opportunity. So I mentioned the circular economy bill, the circular economy route map. There's going to be transformational change in Scotland, of how we, not just how we manage waste and resources in Scotland, but how we view waste and resources in terms of climate change, in terms of material security, supply chain, and that's fundamental to the inputs to our economy. That's not so much what happens at the end of life, that's how we're going to manage this so we can actually use that to input to the economy. That's a massive opportunity for wealth building, and I can't labour that point. Because I can't think of anything more extractive. I mean, that's what we've been talking about here, the extractive industry that is basically our waste system. We take all of that value, all of those materials, whether it's bottles, whether it's plastics, whether it's steel, whether it's rubble, whether it's buildings, we extract all of that out of our communities across Scotland, and it goes off somewhere else. And we're not sure where that is in some respect, but we don't know where that value ends up, but it's taken out of our communities. So that's what's going to shift over the next 5 to 10 years significantly in Scotland, and not just here in Scotland, but at global level. So it's not, but we're seen as one of the leaders. But how could we really maximise that as an opportunity for, you know, community wealth building, both in terms of jobs, in terms of value, in terms of ownership, getting people? Because the whole thing about net zero, you know, if I may, is people will say, and I think I was at an event here where the economist, I'm trying to remember her name, Anne Pettifer, talked about, you know, going around renewable wind installations and talking to communities who had turbines up, who had invested in turbines, but clearly they weren't getting any benefit from them, you know, in terms of their power, because obviously because of the cost of energy, etc. like that. So one of their kind of feedbacks to Anne was, you know, so what's in this for us? It's the same thing as we shift to net zero, we shift to the circular economy, we shift in this direction. Our communities are individual citizens that are going, well, this is all very well, this all makes sense, but what's in it for us? Harnessing that opportunity, particularly in the, from my point of view, from the circular economy, from the energy, from the transport, all of this is going to be happening in a net zero world. What's the opportunity for our individual citizens and our communities? Well, that needs to be designed in, and I take Angus's point. This isn't just a blanket term for what's already happening. We need to get that in. We need to re-plumb the economy. So this is fundamental to every approach that we do, and it's great to see that happening in Louise's area, and in Brobs and Preston as well. But we need to see that, but we need to invade, we need to cover the circular economy bit of it as well, not just think about energy and transport and what's already happening.
Yeah, I think that's tremendous that you brought in the whole the waste piece and that the kind of value to waste, and that really is a shift in consciousness, isn't it? Because we don't really value, like, I love that expression, there's no such thing as a way. And that we really need to shift our sense of valuing.
Interesting thing about jobs is, so for everyone, I mean, we're very good at collection, and I congratulate all local authorities for the collection infrastructure, but for every job there is in collection of materials for recycling, there's another 8 jobs follow up the sort of repurposing, remanufacturing, resupply of those materials back into the economy. And the bulk of the stuff that we collect here in Scotland gets exported out of Scotland. 70 to 75% of the material, other than glass and some organics, most of the materials that we collect here in Scotland gets exported. So we're exporting jobs, opportunity and value. Somebody else has gone, OK, it's getting kept out of landfill, so it's good for the environment, so we're delivering on climate targets, but we're losing the economic opportunity. You know, and if there's 8 jobs in recycling, there's another 15 jobs if we get into reuse and repair. And these are local jobs. I mean, again, the language is very similar. You know, the circular economy is a redistributive economy. It's not about extracting all of those products, materials out of our communities into big factories in the middle of Scotland or wherever. It's about how do we use those materials at a local level for economic and social opportunity. And it's happening. I mean, it comes back to the point that it is already happening in Scotland, I'm sure, in your constituencies. You can point to those opportunities. But how do we make this the mainstream? How do we make this fundamental to our ecosystem that we want to have in Scotland, so it's for the prosperity of not just our places, but also our people?
Yeah, that's certainly very true. I'm aware of a lot of small initiatives that really need that tremendous support. Mark, you had indicated an interest around net zero. I thought maybe it would be a good time, seeing as Ian has started to talk about it, that you could come in.
Yeah, I mean, I think we've kind of skirted round the edges of it this morning, but, you know, Ian, you've really honed in on there is such a huge social and economic change in train in terms of both generation and consumption of heat and electricity. It's about to really ramp up with the really challenging net zero ambitions and targets that we have in Scotland. So I guess my twin question is, one, what is the role of community wealth building in achieving the challenging targets? But I think the more fundamental point is, how do we actually see that shift away from, you know, the economic models that we currently have with generation and consumption of heat and power to ones that are beneficial to communities themselves? Perhaps you've already kicked off on that, Ian. Maybe come back to you and then open it up to those around the table.
Yeah, I mean, I'm always taken by the fact, you know, in terms of the energy, there's good examples of community energy projects already in Scotland. So, I mean, from our point of view, when we talk to individual citizens and communities, they all want to be part of this, the net zero. They want to do the right thing. I mean, people say, oh, people are not interested. They are interested. Believe me, people individually want to take action on climate change. You know, it consistently, you know, is a high priority for them. Things that they're worried about, things that they lose sleep about, you know, it's consistently in the top 3, if not the top 5. It's something they want to do, but they want to be part of it. It goes back to my point. They want, sounds dreadful, they want something out of it for them and their communities. That's it. They're part of the system, whether it's energy demand or consumption, whether it's recycling systems, whether it's active transport and travel. They want to be part of it. They want something out of it. So it is about that co-ownership. How can they be, you know, how can they be part of the delivery of infrastructure, the delivery of services, and actually see some of that, yeah, financial and social benefit coming to them, rather than just, you know, being the users of it? How can they actually get something out of it? That's where you're seeing the most engagement with people in both the communities that we work with in reuse and repair, when they're much more active in this, rather than just using, whatever respect, the recycling services provided by local authorities or by the private sector. It is about how do we get them into the conversations early on and into the design and delivery and ownership. You know, it goes back to Angus's point. You know, sometimes they're not the last people that are asked. There's an assumption that they'll use something or be involved or come along at the end of the day and, you know, be part of something, but they need to be part of the beginning. That's all the work that we've done. It has been how communities have led on that we've really seen the benefits.
Thanks for that. Yeah, definitely need to get that communities, local people leading piece. Neil, you wanted to come in and then I'll come to Angus.
Yeah, great question. You know, we're talking here about community wealth problem, which is economic system change. Yeah, practical, focused, one bit at a time. Yeah, but it's economic system change. And of course, we talk a lot in community wealth problem about wealth extraction, but it's actually about material resource use and extraction fundamentally, as well as wealth. So it's about replumbing the economic system so that there is less wealth extraction there's less material and resource use and extraction. In that, we have to look as a nation at our history, which is based on wealth and material and resource extraction, from the Highland Clearances to the oil and gas industry. So there is something, quite fundamentally important about community wealth building as a practical corrective tool to end a nation that has been suffered from wealth and resource extraction, because it's actually saying the wealth and resources of this country is ours. Yeah, and we need to make sure it works for us within the limits of the within planetary boundaries. And so just take one sector, a key foundational sector, energy, and in terms of wind and renewables, the future in terms of net zero, right? We cannot use the old tools to fix new problems. We can't have monolithic, centralised system of control over energy. We need to have that distributed. Ownership and control is key. And we're at a very important inflection point, I feel, that this is a massive opportunity for us not to go down the previous paths of the Highland Clearances and oil and gas boom, where wealth and material resources were extracted, to actually repatriate this bounty of wind and other renewables to the Scottish people so we genuinely own it. And I'm not talking about, you know, Scottish Energy Company. I'm talking about Scots Energy Company, yeah, where there's many communities all across Scotland who own their own, they own the land, energy is produced, and they distribute it to the communities and in Scotland as a whole. And maybe there's mechanisms in terms of a coordinating network body at the Scottish nation. So we're only going to achieve the net zero targets, I think, by placing ownership and control more in the hands of us. And that requires less monolithic and centralised energy systems, but one that's much more distributed, and we have a genuine stake in it.
OK, thank you. Angus?
Well, I mean, in terms of doing something about that very centralised distribution system for the energy, I think the horse might have bolted already on that one, because the UK government is investing billions of pounds in infrastructure on the national grid to take the power down from Shetland and Orkney and the Western Isles and down into to England. That is already underway. But having said that, you know, I mean, if community wealth building is about who owns economic activity and the assets that generate wealth, then there is a real opportunity within this. Again, it needs to bleed across into other parts of government activity. But, you know, I mean, the ownership of community renewables, of renewable energy, has dropped off a cliff in the last few years. It's not happened. And that's because it's incredibly difficult to get to financial close all the way through the process. So that needs to be made a lot easier. But there are incredible opportunities from, you know, communities benefiting from community benefit payments from private developers to shared ownership with private developers, which is increasingly on offer. But to 100% ownership, that's where the real gains happen. And you talked about earlier the Western Isles, some of the communities there who are generating millions of pounds relatively to and compared to their community. I mean, they are ineffective. They are a community anchor institution. They are delivering real social good to their community and beyond. And actually, it almost brings into question who is the local authority. You know, the community trusts who are developing Point and Sandwick, which is a tiny community in the Western Isles, is issued a dividend of £3 million to its community last year. I mean, and that money is going out to support community stuff and improve lifestyles right across the Western Isles. So amazing possibilities. Also, in terms of the offshore, we haven't really established what the community benefit should be from that, but that is, you know, should be hundreds of millions of pounds coming into the community. And the national grid and the infrastructure investment that they're already making is a community benefit fund of well over £100 million. So there is substantial cash waiting out there, sloshing around. We're not sure where it's going to go. And if we're not careful, we're going to lose it. But it's a real opportunity to create some kind of community wealth fund that can support all of this community acquisition of assets and really drive this agenda forward at a local level and put communities on the front foot. You know, I was asking earlier, where is the community voice in all of this? Well, a properly structured community wealth fund could support all of that.
And it would have that kind of also distribution aspect, because I hear certainly in my region there's some communities that get that incredible wealth and others, a neighbouring community that doesn't have it. And how do we actually make sure that everybody benefits from it? I'm going to bring in Rob and then Matthew and then Mark. Go back to Mark. He's got a final question.
Thank you very much, Convener. So just really three brief points and feedback that communities that we've spoken to about the prospect of community shared ownership, certainly in this instance, rather than outright ownership, and the feedback is, and I hope they'll recognise it if they hear this session, we're really interested in this, we see the benefit of it, but we are concerned about governance and risk and the ability to raise the money, the unfamiliarity of the market with the opportunity that's available here. So those three things, so far as they're concerned, are the, at this point, potentially insurmountable barriers, and realistically, they're looking to all of us, I think, collectively, to try and remove them so that they can make a good job of the investment and managing the money that comes in the way that they're absolutely, totally and already demonstrably capable of doing, because they already have track records of really some brilliant achievement. They just want to be able to step up to the next level, and they're looking for our assistance to remove those potential blockages that they see to getting to that point.
Yeah, certainly very helpful. That's what we're looking for. How do we remove the blockages? Matthew, you wanted to come in.
Really briefly, in response to Mark's question, obviously it's general election year, isn't it? And without getting to the party politics of it, there's obviously debates about, you know, GB energy, if there is a change of government. And if there is that change of government, that will then be linked to local power plans, which will support cooperative and community energy, really. So that is quite interesting, the fact that the community wealth building debate seems to be getting onto the national stage in terms of how that might be applied. But I do think, just in terms of tackling the climate crisis, we do need to have a fundamental change in the way we think. I think, for example, the amount that's spent on advertising is very wasteful. And I think as a society, we've become too materialistic in the way that we think. I think trying to change that is the way that we're going to tackle it, really. It's going to be hard for politicians to do that, because I think it doesn't always win votes. But if we're serious about safeguarding future generations, children, grandchildren, we just can't carry on the way we are in terms of consumption, in terms of waste. And I think it's how we deliver that change. But things like community wealth building and community and publicly owned energy will be a step forward.
I think that's certainly a good point around needing to change our materialistic direction of travel, but also, yeah, very challenging for us to really be able to tackle that, especially when everybody's looking at their screens and being told the next thing that they need to have in their lives to make their lives so brilliant. Mark, you've got a question.
Thanks, Bina. My next question was about national performance frameworks. Parliament is about to consider a refreshed version of those. And just to ask round the table, how community wealth building and tackling the challenge of tackling inequality is feeding into the national performance framework. Is there anything that we need to do to give that, you know, higher importance within that national framework to encourage more development on the ground?
Anybody? Neil?
Yeah, I'm not. I was for a while in the Scottish Government seconded in, and there was conversations around the linking with community wealth building with the wellbeing monitor and obviously feeding into MPF. I'm not where it's got to. But in terms of just separate work that I've been doing, there's a whole range of national performance that could fit around community wealth building, particularly the five pillars. So there's things like, you know, in terms of finance, you would look at percentage increase in ethical investment and lending, a decrease in percentage of population facing financial insecurity. I could go on, but across all the pillars, there's a range of things. And I think community wealth building in other parts of the world lend itself to that, if you like, a suite of indicators and performance measures that really start to dig deep into a different economic, social, environmental destination of our nation. So I think there is community wealth building lends itself to the pillars, they're all themes, then you've got indicators from there, and then that can be aggregated up into what a national performance framework should be. So, personally speaking, I would like to see community wealth building
indicators lodged firmly within a broader suite of national performance framework indicators, because it's got that route back to the practice and got that route back to real change to people's lives.
Can I ask, because so the national performance, so you're kind of saying, well, so do we need to reverse engineer our performance framework? That's one question. But the other bit is that you mentioned planetary boundaries earlier, and the national performance framework has the sustainable development goals embedded into it. So I think there's an opportunity potentially to look at that donut economics, or whatever you want to call it, piece along with this community wealth building. Kind of, I feel like this conversation is brilliant because it's kind of pulling a lot of strands together. Now we've got the circular economy element in, the local governance review, but yeah.
Yeah, no, it's a really good point. I'm glad you brought that up. And I looked at the, I've looked extensively at the Welsh government's adoption at a local level of well-being indicators that link to the sustainable development goals. And that's great and laudable. However, I think its imperfections is it doesn't relate to concrete action on the ground. I like to see a DNA or a strong spine that goes to, here is what we're trying to achieve as a nation, here's the indicators, and here's the practical policy, and here's the practical action that all relate to that. My perception is that in Wales, and the adoption of sustainable development goals in other countries around the world, including in partly New Zealand, is that that spinal connection I'm talking about is not there. And I think we need to be wary of the disconnect between aspirations as a nation and what the hell we're actually going to be doing. I'm an advocate for community wealth building, evangelist, is that I believe community wealth building has that connection because it's rooted in fair work, economic democracy, these key questions around the pillars.
Okay, great. Thanks. I'm going to bring in Stephanie with a supplementary and then Linda.
Thanks very much, convener. Just when you're talking there, Neil, kind of brings to mind a local company that I've got in my constituency, ACS Clothing, which some of you might already have heard of, who started off doing kilt hire and stuff like that, but they've shifted over towards looking at access over ownership and circular economy. But the point that I wanted to pick up on something that they're doing is, as far as work and recruitment processes are concerned, they're actually deliberately targeting refugees, neurodiverse people, older people, people with disabilities, people with criminal records who can find it quite hard to get work. So I'm just wondering what kind of type of opportunities might there be to actually promote that type of thing as well to help reduce inequality?
Sorry, I'm butting in. Sorry, Kavina. Nope. What a lovely example. I'd like to know more about that. I would say, as an advocate for plural forms of ownership, for inclusive forms of ownership, and incidentally, I independently chair the review on inclusive business models in Scotland as part of the NSET Action 44. But I would say, as an advocate for those sorts of forms, is that when you have an organisation in types of firms where there's a deeper level of worker, community, control and ownership, you do tend to see greater levels of humanity, decency and common sense. And that's the example I gave earlier from California, indicative of that. An economy that has a high percentage of inclusive ownership models will have an economy on balance, which would be more decent, fair and green. So we need to encourage more of, and I'm sure that company managed to achieve its successes in part in spite of the system. We need to have an economic system that makes it really easy for that company to do that, what it's done.
Thanks for that. Thanks for bringing that in. Linda and then Ian. And I think then we're going to have to wrap up this incredible conversation. Linda.
Just coming back on the point about national performance indicators, I mean, I mentioned earlier about collective sectoral bargaining, and I think that's something that we'd still need to want to look at. And within the context of community wealth building, then thinking about fair work. So there's a lot more evaluation that can be done around pay in Scotland, secure work in Scotland, insecure work. How do we move away from that? What are the jobs that are destined to not be with us? Because when we're thinking about just transition, there are jobs that we could earmark that are not going to be with us. And therefore, how do we make sure that the potential that we've got for using pluralist ownership models within energy and other infrastructure to make sure that there is good quality green jobs that are going to be the future and that we can skill for them. And that can be done at regional level as well as obviously national. But we also want to look at pay gaps within that. I mean, Scotland's just recently, the latest figures show that the disability pay gap in Scotland has gone up, you know, so there is, you know, a more nuanced version of, you know, what are the gaps within pay and pay structures that we've got and what's the difficulty within that. And we'll keep coming back to the point that obviously strong trade unions mean that we're going to end up with a better pay for people and terms and conditions, because one of the things that we're finding is that in work poverty, whilst that's a huge issue, it's also around the terms and conditions that people are having to work under. And being, since COVID particularly, as workforces have shrunk, particularly in the public sector in certain areas, the people that are left are being asked to do more and more and more. So then take on new initiatives just feels like a step too far. So there's something there about the resourcing. And I know we said it's not always about resourcing, but actually sometimes it is. And the consultation responses themselves note that there was a very strong view that a structural transformation of this scale envisaged in the consultation paper is likely to require significant additional resources. Now, local authorities are not going to be able to, whether it's taken on one community wealth building person who's now gone part-time, they're not going to make this change unless there is a direction of travel, both in terms of leadership, political leadership, but some funding to do that as well. A point I just wanted to reflect on quickly as well, thinking about, you might talk about housing, and land. I mean, one of the things Open's trying to do this on their own, I mean, I've tried it on a smaller scale in other places. I mean, one of the things that we would ask Scottish Government to do when we're talking about wealth is to evaluate that wealth. How do we actually know where the wealth lies? Because we haven't evaluated our property in Scotland for a very long time. Council tax has not been re-evaluated, and council tax bans, sorry, have not been re-evaluated for decades and decades. And if also we haven't got a land ownership map. So, you know, there are things, and what is the wealth of that land? So there's some specific points there. There's a rule about housing as well when we look at our communities, and one of the biggest places that developers are throwing money at is purpose-built student accommodation, and what is the impact of that? And universities as anchor institutions have a role within that to say, what do they want? Where do they want their students housed within communities? Because students also do not want to live in these accommodation. They would much rather be part of a community. So there's a tension there, I think, amongst communities about when they see that the only thing that's being developed that's shiny and new is often owned entirely abroad and it isn't part of their own community. And I think there's a very last point. If we want people to have agency within communities and within workplaces to take part in this, they have to have the capacity to do so. You know, and that's partly our job as trade unions, and trade union education is to get people organised in workplaces to take part. But they have to have access. We need to make sure that trade unions have access to workplaces and that they work with employers on data sharing to say where are jobs being created and how can unions be involved. But for communities as well, we're asking a lot from people who'd already pretty knackered to take part in things and have agency. You know, and often it comes down to individuals who can step up, who's got the actual privilege to have time away from work commitments, family, home, care and responsibilities, their own abilities, physically and mentally, to take part. So we're asking quite a lot. So sometimes there's that imbalance that when we ask people to volunteer, there's only sections of society that can actually participate. And one of the things that would help around that was actually putting funding in to community development, as we see in some smaller places, but also specifically into community organising. Because sometimes when communities come together, they come together over one thing. And when that is either won or lost, and it can be either of those outcomes, that dissipates. It was a transactional thing. Let's all get together to save a thing, to do a thing, to stop a service leaving us. And they either win or lose, and then people walk away. Where actually community organising allows for not just that transactional, but a much more transformational situation, which is longer lasting. And in England and Wales, ironically, there is actually the UK government gives some funding to an organisation called Community Organising. And we have nothing like that in Scotland. There's no funding available. And there was research just came out recently about the amount of money that goes into communities projects, but not into community organising. So I think there's something there that we should look at as a recommendation.
Yeah, absolutely. We need that soft infrastructure. OK, I'm going to bring in Ian and then we're going to close because we still have a few little things to do and I know colleagues need to get to other places. Ian.
Yeah, sorry. Just a quick point. ACS Clothing, we know them very well. They're kind of the poster boys of the circular economy in Scotland. But it is about, it's interesting what you say because quite a few businesses we work with similarly employ, you know, particularly people, refugees and asylum seekers coming to the country, and they also come with skills. There's a big thing that we're, you know, we talk about the circular economy, particularly when we think about reuse and repair and ACS clothing, have to repair some of the kilts and jackets and clothing that comes back. You know, there's a big thing, people say, we don't have the skills anymore, exactly, we've lost those skills in our communities. Actually, you know, there's a degree of truth in that, and there's obviously investment in that, but actually, these refugees and people like that who are coming in, and even, you know, ex-offenders and stuff like that, are actually got skills, skills that are valuable to the new economy that we're talking about here, you know, and they've got something to bring. So, you know, the more of that, absolutely, we should be promoting that. You know, when we talk about, you know, particularly we talk about the circular economy and that, you know, about where do these skills lie. They lie within our communities, the totality of our communities, not just the specific individuals who have been to college or training and stuff like that.
Great. Okay. Gosh, what a brilliant conversation. I do feel like we've just kind of scratched the surface in a way. I think we got to some very useful points. I think there's some pointers in there around, you know, I mean, obviously the reason for this conversation is because of the forthcoming community wealth building bill. And so, you know, is there a need for that legislation? I think that's come clear, but I think there's also aspects around a shifting culture and consciousness in a way around cooperation, collaboration, working together, communities leading potentially as well. But lots for us to certainly take away. And I think we'll be coming back to some of you, or maybe all of you, for a bit more detail on things there. But it's been really a very rich morning. Thanks for letting us go on quite a bit longer than we had planned. And I now briefly suspend the meeting to allow you all to leave the room. The next item on our agenda today is to consider the following negative instruments: non-domestic rates, islands and remote area hospitality relief, Scotland Regulations 2024, SSI 2024/55, and domestic rates transitional relief, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024, SSI 2024/59. There's no requirement for the committee to make any recommendations on negative instruments. Do members have any comments on these instruments? Nobody has any comments. Has the committee agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instruments? Thank you. We're all agreed. Previously, we agreed to take the next item in private. So as that was the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public part of the meeting.